We are the Org. Our mission is to assimilate Star Trek The Next Generation, Star Trek Deep Space Nine, and beer. Lots of beer.
Hello, friends!
Hello!
Welcome to bOrgCast 8.M.
Point M.
The M stands for movie. Woohoo! Because we're covering generations. But first, some news! Since last time we recorded, it's been announced that Nicholas Meyer will be one of the writers and one of the executive producers for Star Trek 2017, or whatever we're calling it.
The TV series.
Mm-hmm. Which is interesting news. Of course, he's the man behind Star Treks 2 and 6.
Yeah, arguably the best Trek films.
Although it has been some... I'm going to criticise either 2 or 6, but... Sometimes his low-tech approach rankled me slightly. The fact that, you know, you have to have kitchens and, you know, he kind of brought the technology back a few decades. But he still made bloody good films.
Yeah.
So, you. But obviously he's not going to be directing. So, I don't know. I don't know how I feel about that one. But anyway, we shall see. Okay, let's move on. And here's our trailer for Generations.
In a distant corner of our galaxy, a secret observatory is attacked. A brilliant scientist is found, and a mysterious ribbon of energy where past and future collide is unleashed.
It's a doorway that we call the Nexus.
Every ship which has approached the ribbon has either been destroyed or severely damaged.
Obviously, they were looking for something.
There's still no indication of why they attacked the station.
I must return to the observatory immediately.
There's nothing I can do.
Timing is very important in my experiment.
Where the hell's he going?
I have an appointment with Eternity, and I don't want to be late.
Someone doesn't care about weapons or power. He just cares about getting back to the Nexus.
The star is going to collapse in a matter of minutes.
That'll destroy everything in this system.
Population?
230 million, sir.
Why would he destroy a star?
I have to stop him. But I can't do this alone. I need help.
I know someone who can.
You say history considers me dead.
Who am I to argue with history?
You're a Starfleet officer. You have a duty.
I don't need to be lectured by you. I was out saving the galaxy when your grandfather was in diapers.
Now, the torch of adventure is about to be passed.
Eliminate them.
Klingon vessel decloaking directly ahead, sir.
Target their bridge!
Fool disruptors!
Let's go!
Bridge, we have a new problem!
All right, let's move them out. Let's go. Take them out.
10 seconds to warp core breach.
Warhead, brace for impact!
Let's try and cheat death together.
Warp 1, engage!
Star Trek Generations.
So a little bit of background information first.
Uh-huh.
Rick Berman and Paramount executives decided the first Next Generation film would involve passing the baton between the old series and the new.
But that wasn't necessary.
Controversial decision for starters, yeah. 3 different stories were commissioned from writers, but Michael Piler turned down the opportunity on the basis he wasn't comfortable with the idea of a writing competition. Maurice Hurley's script had Kirk only appearing as a hologram, advising the new crew, which is an interesting concept, but not as cool as getting the actual generations to meet physically. Whereas Ron Moore and Brandon Braga's script originally had the 2 Enterprise crews battling each other, which sounds bizarre, okay. That he abandoned that as one crew or the other would look like the bad guys, and instead they went for the idea that we get in film. But all the way through, the plan was that Kirk was going to die.
Except he doesn't, because he's alive in the Nexus.
No, he's not. He's dead. And the Nexus passes on, so he's dead.
No, but the first time around, he's
the first time, no. But that's kind of the sleight of hand thing, isn't it? But they were always going to kill him.
Yeah, but there's Guinan in the Nexus, so you're never...
She's not anymore. Don't worry about... Don't just... Oh, let's not get hung up on that yet.
You'll
have your time for that one. As originally written, all the original series crew were going to feature, but both Leonard Nimoy and DeForest Kelly felt that they said their goodbyes to their characters in Star Trek VI.
All of them did. They are right.
Someone, where's Spock then? It's like, oh. Now yeah. We've got to explain this. Nimoy was offered the directing job as kind of a sort of sweetener to try and make him appear in the film, but he backed out when his suggested script changes were rejected, because the other movies he'd been involved with, he was always involved from the scripts onwards. Yeah. So, yeah. He felt his lines weren't particularly Spock-like, which was proved when they were given to Doohan and Koenig, basically. And, of course, Sulu's lines were given to his daughter.
Yeah.
And there's absolutely no mention of Uhura at all, which is criminal. But there we go.
Yeah. Pile of wank.
Production of the film began while Season 7 Next Generation was still underway, although coming to its end, obviously. And, of course, the first things they filmed were all the original series crew stuff on the Enterprise B. So, do you want to take us through the first half of the film, my dear?
So, your opening credits are obviously based on the motionless picture, because it takes fucking ages for a champagne bottle, presumably fired out of a torpedo tube, to give it sufficient momentum to make its way slowly to the Enterprise B.
Well, this wasn't going to be the original opening shots. You've seen the original opening shots on Extras, which is Kirk doing his skydiving business from orbit. Yeah, actually, I prefer the champagne bottle idea, personally. It took me ages to realise what was going on to begin with. But funnily enough, our son watching it this evening was like, what's going on? And it's like, yeah, what is that thing? And then you make it out that
the
it's a bottle.
The answer is nothing.
It's a bottle. It's like,
yes, but it takes...
Why is there a bottle flying through
space? Oh, I know, but it takes 17 years more than it should.
Well, I quite like it, so no. This is not the first time we're going to disagree.
No, but it's sort of, you know... Setting out its stall. Hello, nothing happening, pile of wank.
No, that's not true. Plenty happens. Some of it doesn't make an awful lot of sense, but plenty happens in this film.
Okay.
It's not got many boring scenes, but it's not like the motion picture, which does have plenty of boring scenes.
No, but that one is. It reminded me of the motionless picture, because it just takes too bloody long.
It's a mysterious start, which admittedly the second time around doesn't work.
And supposedly with really dramatic music. It's
I like the music.
Off.
Then we get to see the Enterprise B.
Yes. Now it's time to get anal about space.
Woohoo!
Took a trip on the Gemini spacecraft.
Which is a modified... Well, come on, we've got to get anal about spaceships. Keep your interest.
You have your own podcast for that now.
I'm not sure we're going to be covering the Enterprise B. We are going to be doing at some point an Enterprise special. Sadly, I don't think any of us is going to be choosing the Enterprise B. Well, I say sadly because it's a bit of an ugly bug, it has to be said. I mean, they took the Excelsior model, which isn't everybody's favourite, and then they stuck a whole great big chunk on the bottom so that they could show the damage of the ribbon without damaging the original model.
So the Excelsior had a poo.
No, it suffered from a beer belly or something. I don't quite know how you describe what that... Apparently, it's supposed to sort of model a Catalina flying boat, which you can kind of see, but it's not a pretty look, it has to be said. Also, they added an extra impulse deck, the idea being that it could saucer SEP, and it's a big saucer, so they need an extra impulse engine. John Eaves, who was that modified it, added a few extra fins... Which was his want at the time. See also the future Enterprise in All Good Things. Although sometimes it's stock footage they use when it's at warp, and that's the original model. But you're not going to notice that really unless you know. And the scenes where it's shown with the ribbon are CG scenes. So it's a CG model because it's a lot easier to do the lighting. And to be honest, it slightly shows because it's clearly not as detailed. The model was later reused, he says, poking her awake. As the Lakota in Deep Space Nine. I mentioned Deep Space Nine, wake up. Deep Space Nine's Paradise Lost from Season 4. But, yeah, it's a bit on the fugly side, sadly. Can I geek out about the dry dock it's in now? Because that dry dock dates from your favourite film, Star Trek The Motion Picture. They've modified it a bit. Okay, I'm finished now, you can carry on. Wake up! There's a whole movie to do yet.
Bugger. Okay. So, there's lots of press and stuff.
And we meet the crew of the Enterprise B.
Yeah.
Time to play. Recognise any of these?
No.
Oh, come on.
Well, no, there's not Tuvok.
There is not Tuvok. If you don't recognise blooming Tim Russ... Then I'm sorry.
No, there is not. I called him not Tuvok in my notes.
Yes. very curious he got. This was before he got cast as Tuvok. And, of course, later in Voyager's history, we learn that he was aboard the Excelsior in Star Trek VI. But here, he's clearly not the Vulcan Tuvok because he doesn't have pointy ears.
I don't recognise anybody else.
You don't recognise anybody else?
No.
So you don't recognise Captain Harriman?
No.
Okay, he's played by Alan Ruck.
That's nice for him.
We watched him recently in Speed. He was the irritating passenger that you're really relieved gets kicked off the bus.
Oh, right, okay. Fine.
Now, Captain Harriman, it has to be said, has been rather unfairly treated by fans over the years. He's sent out in an unready ship, and he's hung out to dry by the top brass because it's not his fault it's not been equipped with anything. He didn't decide to launch it at this point. So it's not his fault, basically.
It's not his fault it's not Tuesday.
Yes, exactly. It's some admiral somewhere to blame. Yeah. As per fucking usual, yes.
Do you reckon he's Admiral Shonky?
It could have well been Admiral Shonky's fault, yes. We're blaming her now. The science officer you might have recognised, Jeanette Goldstein. She was Vasquez in Aliens.
Okay. But no, I didn't recognise her.
Although she does look rather different in that. And she's also in Terminator 2 and Die Hard 2, although I can't say I remember her from either of those. You've got the con officer, who was Thomas Kopashi, who was last seen as the train engineer in Emergence.
Uh-huh.
And he was the Romulan Mirok in the next phase.
Yeah, so I'd know him why.
Because you've seen him twice. Once recently.
Behind a load of makeup.
Well,
once,
not a load, but yeah.
And once in a really wanky episode.
Yeah, and only briefly before he got shot, yeah. Actually. Okay, I'll give you a pass for not recognising Thomas Kopashi, because he's very much a bit actor. But Glenn Morshower, you should have recognised Glenn Morshower, the
Why?
Ginger Wonder. Because he's been in everything, usually playing generals. He was a navigation officer in this, but he was Riker's tactical officer on the Hathaway.
Ha ha, this way. I sing that when we play attack.
Although it has been a little while since we've seen peak performance.
Fair. Yes.
But he's the general in X-Men First Class.
I haven't seen
all
that
the generals in the Transformers movies.
I haven't seen any of them. I have no intention of.
Well, you're a very wise person.
Yes.
Because they're rubbish.
They are.
And one of the reporters is the dude who played the Benzite in season one and
yeah,
two.
Yeah, I'm going to know that why.
Yeah, fair enough. Right. I'll give you a pass on that one as well.
Yes, fine. So, it's basically not Tuvok.
Yep.
Bloke from Speed, who fair enough I might have recognised.
Yep.
And people who've played other minor bit parts in episodes a long time ago, or that are wank, or both.
And Glenn Morshower, who's in everything, but usually as generals.
Yeah, but who I don't really remember.
Okay.
And he isn't actually got a big role in this, is he? I mean,
not really, no.
No. I mean, it's not like, you know, I have to sort of burn the image of the ginger dude into my face in order to, you know.
Burn that image. Remember, yeah. Time is the
yes.
In which we burn.
Oh, fuck the fuck off.
Anyway, let's move on, shall we?
Yes, right, so.
So the set of the Enterprise B.
Oh, fuck off!
Well, come on, it's an Enterprise. We've got to feature it, haven't we?
Oh, fine. You do that. I'll just drink beer in a corner. You can call me back when you're fucking finished.
Well, I didn't think much of the captain's chair, it has to be said.
Oh, fucking hell. I cannot believe this. Where is my beer?
But the displays were good. They're all in keeping with the original series era.
Oh, no, they're not, because they have the L cars.
And back in the... Well, they're not quite the... next gen L cars.
No, but they're not like
they're transitioning.
No, they're more like the next gen than they should have been.
No. I think it's about right at this point.
No, I don't. Not when you see Kirk leaping unnecessarily around holes that shouldn't be there later on, and moving chips around that are blatantly bits of shitty, slightly pink perspex. No.
And we also have the separate helm and navigation station still from original series era as well.
Oh, right, yes, because that's important.
Yeah, I think it is.
Fine.
Carry on.
Finally, do I actually get to speak now?
Possibly. For a bit.
Bloody hell. Having your own spaceship podcast hasn't fixed this one. It's fucking made you worse. I'm surprised you're not trying to ask for points for the Enterprise B.
We're going to rate it now.
Yes.
Oh, you should be so glad I hadn't thought of that before. Because I could have gone into our point system as well.
I know. I'd have fucking left the room.
You probably left the house.
Yeah.
I'll go into the pub.
Yes. Yes, I would have done. Even though I'm in my fucking dressing gown.
Oh, dear. I think you'll be all right for a bit now.
Do you think?
Yeah, until you get to the cool.
Oh, right. I don't think I even named the bloody ship. Anyway, right. So, supposedly, this is the handover with the original series crew.
Yeah.
But we don't have Sulu.
No.
We only have his daughter, yeah. Supposedly, who we've never met before.
No, she's nice, though.
Yeah, but we've never met her before. Mrs. Mitchell. Anyway, so we've got
Mrs. Mitchell.
As in Mitchell.
Oh, okay, Mitchell of the Week. Okay,
yeah, right.
The so Babylon she's... 5 reference that yeah. Even I didn't get. Well
no,
done.
Yeah. So she's Mrs. Mitchell, and there's no Uhura, yep. And there's no Spock.
Nope.
So it isn't handing over the baton. They mm-hmm. all say goodbye in Star Trek 6. The reason the whole thing feels fucking awkward and Kurt doesn't know what to do is because the whole thing shouldn't be fucking happening because it's all fucking awkward. Fuck the fuck
I off. Tell you what would have been better, okay? And I would...
A big poo!
And I would have lived with this a lot more comfortably had it just been Kirk. I think that would have solved the problems.
It would have just emphasised how much the original series was just all about fucking Shatner, who's so fucking awesome in this series he can't even fucking die.
But it was always going to have two captains, okay? There was no Why? Point having more... Because you know, what a cool idea.
No, it isn't.
It was at the time. I mean, you might argue about the realisation, but ultimately it was a cool idea of having two captains of the Enterprise. But as soon as you start including other members of the crew, you're kind of going, well, why haven't you included everybody? It's like, as you pointed out, Shatner's ego means that Shatner on his own, to be honest, is fairly predictable.
Yeah.
But as soon as you include one or two of the other crew, you've got to include them all, really.
Yeah.
So that's bad.
No, and no, there was no need to pass the baton.
And neither passed. Scotty nor... Scotty slightly, but certainly not Chekhov anyway. Chekhov's clearly using mostly McCoy's lines. He even goes to bloody sickbay at one point. It's like, come on. This could have been anybody.
Yeah, no. Totally unnecessary.
Mm-hmm.
Next Gen found its own with Best of Both Worlds. Totally unnecessary pile of wank. So then they're there having this sort of official launch with most things not there. They get a distress call with the ship going, we can't break free! And immediately I broke into song.
I want to break free! I want to break free!
But they can't.
Ah, so we're talking about the call now, are we?
Well, I didn't name the ship.
There's two of them, for starters.
Yeah, but now this is... this. We're going to have to do a sidebar here, okay? Because I don't know whether what I'm about to say is a genuine criticism of the film or me getting confused.
Okay.
So, they're transporting Elorian refugees to Earth.
Yes.
But in the Next Generation...
Yes.
Guinan's system was destroyed by the Borg.
And that's exactly what's happened here.
But... Guinan was on Earth with Mark Twain.
Ah, no. That's not a point of confusion, because later on, one presumes she went back to Eloria, or whatever you're calling her planet. So that's not necessarily a problem. It's just that in her past, she was on Earth, and the past to this as well.
Yes.
Okay. The problem actually is here, we've got, is that there are all these refugees from Eloria, from the Borg attack.
Yes.
And they're heading to Earth. And this is back in the days of the original series.
Yeah.
So they've travelled all the way from the fecking Delta Quadrant?
Yeah.
And Earth is the nearest place to take refuge? What?
Yeah, well that's...
Makes no sense.
But do we ever get told that Eloria's in the Delta Quadrant, though?
Well, it must be if they were attacked by the Borg. Because the Borg are in the Delta Quadrant at this point in history. It's only once we get to... which one is it? Q title? A Q who... Q... Who gives a monkeys? When the good
fuck
one,
you, yeah.
Fuck you, yes, the good one. Where Q transports them into the Delta Quadrant to meet the Borg for the first time. Okay, that's the first we hear of the Borg. Yeah. So all these refugees have stayed shum all these years.
Yeah, that's what
about
I mean.
The Borg attack. Doesn't work.
So it's not me being confused.
No, it is.
It is a genuine criticism
this
of the movie.
One of the genuine criticisms which I will not defend. There are several things wrong with this movie, and that's one of them.
Right. Okay.
Can I talk about the L'Cool now? And the SS Robert Fox, not that it's named on screen, because that's the name of the other ship. It was named after the Twatchish ambassador from A Taste of Armageddon. You know, the one where they all go in the showers to die? It's that weird planet where the computer decides who's died as a result of the simulated attack.
Oh, no, yes.
And at one point he's declared dead, but he's as all ambassadors are in the original series, he's blubbing annoying. Anyway, he may as well be a Commodore, that would have finished him off. Yeah, both the Lakul and the other ship are CGI-rendered ships, the first completely CGI ships in Star Trek.
Right.
That's my little factoid. Not great designs, but we don't see them up close, so it doesn't matter.
Fine.
They quite quickly blow up.
Yes.
They're Worfen-class transports, apparently.
Right.
You're really pleased to have heard that.
Yes.
Yes, okay.
So they're stuck in the ribbon. Stuck in the ribbon with you.
Nice.
Sorry, I coped with songs.
Yes.
That was my coping mechanism. There might be quite a few as a result. And because it isn't Tuesday, the Enterprise B has no tractor beam.
Mm-hmm.
So they're going to have to enter the ribbon themselves in order to transport people off. They're looking for medics. There aren't any, so Chekhov creates some. This is the point where our son asks, where is Spock? One ship has blown up. Kablooey.
Yeah.
200 and something, or rather, I didn't catch the exact amount, but over 200
mm-hmm.
people dead.
200 Mitchells.
Yeah. And then the second one is going, and Scotty manages to beam some of them out.
And this is Scotty-ish, to be fair. Producing wonders from the transporters. That I can live with. Maybe if it had been Kirk and Scotty, that would have worked nicely. But as I say, the whole Chekhov and the rest... Anyway, let's not dwell on that.
No. I mean, Scotty, in a way, works because of relics.
He does, kind of, as well. But, yeah, it makes sense. In terms of, you know, clearly they need an engineer for plot purposes, so you can have Scotty, aren't you?
Yeah.
You didn't need anybody else.
So, if Scotty at this point is on the B, he isn't on the Janolan?
No, this is before he sets off for his retirement at the Janolan, because he's wearing his uniform.
Scotty manages to rescue 47 out of 150-something. So you add the 150 to the 235, whatever it was.
That's a lot of Mitchells.
And then you get your first appearance of Soren Lorenzen.
Yes, Malcolm McDowell. He was a last-minute casting decision, apparently. He, of course, has been in some classic films. Clockwork Orange.
Not seen it. Don't even
I saw quarter an hour, maybe 20 minutes before deciding this really wasn't for me. The only reason I was watching is because it's filmed where we used to live in Thamesmead. Yeah. He was in If, which I have seen, as a Community.
Oh.
Yeah, he was Professor Cornwallis.
Yes, he was.
Cool name.
But I've seen him in other stuff when he was younger, though. What have I seen him in when he was younger?
I don't know, my dear.
Okay. But seriously, I have seen him in stuff when he was younger,
yep.
But not Clockwork Orange.
He's done more than his fair share of crap films and TV as well, though. He apparently was in the Halloween remake, not that we've seen that. He was in the Home Alone TV movie. Fancy having that on your bloody CV.
No.
He was in Lex. Let's not dwell on Lex.
I
liked aspects of Lex, but it was always generally massively disappointing, it has to be said. But that's a story for another day. He was in Tank Girl, apparently, as well. Which I did watch once, but most of it has passed, thankfully, into the memories of time.
Uh-huh.
Yes. Of course, his nephew is Alexander Siddig.
Really?
Yep. Who later said his uncle's reported reaction to the script for Generations was that it was shit.
No, that's not wrong.
But he liked being the idea of being the man to kill Kirk, though, which is something that slightly backfired on him, because he reportedly received death threats for shooting the legend.
Okay.
Ugh, Star Trek fans, please. Yeah. Some Star Trek fans.
Some, yes. Because we're Star Trek fans, we wouldn't do that.
Indeed.
No. I'd clap him on the back.
He's kind of the crazy uncle no one wants to be near at the party in this, isn't he?
Oh, yeah, can you imagine poor Alexander Siddig?
Yeah.
At parties with that uncle.
Uncle, yeah.
Oh, no.
Oh, man. He's not a great... This is one, and again, another of the faults of the film. He's not great.
No. I'll get on to some of that in a minute.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, Soren Lorenzen is going, let me go back, let me go back.
Really badly acted.
Yeah, and I'm thinking, yeah, I'll let you go back, fuck off. So how are they going to escape from the ribbon? It's not Tuesday, so they don't have any torpedoes. So Kirk goes to sort the deflector. It works, but there's damage. And then you get Chekhov called down. He goes, my God, was anyone in here? And it was Kirk, he's dead. Except he's not, but, you know, they think he is.
Well, when you originally see it, it's a nice misstep, because it's like, Well, I suppose it isn't, because you saw still pictures of Kirk and Picard, so you knew that that wasn't him dead. But quite quickly leaked that Kirk died in this film, and they effectively kill him off in the first 10 minutes, which is quite clever. It's very similar, obviously, to Star Trek II, where they kill Spock off in the first 10 minutes, except he's not really. So you can't criticise him for playing that trick again.
No.
The Deflector Control Room was a set that was originally, they were hoping to be a lot bigger, and they downscaled it. And they made it rather more sort of vertical than horizontal, which is quite clever. It creates an atmosphere of...
It's just lots of leaping around unnecessary holes and gaps and things and rails and these bollocks.
I quite like it, but there you are. It's a cramped and atmospheric set, I think. And I love, love, love the shot from outside the ship looking in.
No, that I like.
With Scotty, Chekhov and Harriman.
Yes.
I can see my house from here.
But no, that is a good shot.
I mean, it's not brilliantly well composited onto the model, but nevertheless, I like the effort. It's a nice one.
And also, although I don't like the design of the set for the Deflector Hoobly, I like the way that particular bit is directed.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't hate 100% of this film. I can recognise that there are some good aspects. Good.
There is hope for you yet.
Yeah, about 5% I like. 78 years later... And yes, you have this,
what a caption.
We have this unnecessary fucking stupid ritual that with the pirate ship that we have never seen before.
It's not a pirate ship, that's what our son kept calling it, but he doesn't know any better.
Fucking tea clipper ship then.
Yes.
This totally fucking unnecessary stupid ritual, which we have never seen before and will never see again, involves Worf getting a hat.
Hat.
Yes. Yeah. And then they remove the plank. And so he ends up in the water.
Oh, it's so funny.
And then Data responds by pushing Crusher into the water.
Which is marginally more funny. But he gets in trouble for it.
Yeah. And Geordi's like, it's not funny. And it's like, fuck the fuck off, it is funny. I was laughing.
I would have been laughing a lot more if it had not been obviously Pat Tallman in the water.
It's blatantly Pat Tallman.
Rather than Gates McFadden.
It's blatantly Pat Tallman in the water.
But probably she'd fall in the water. She'd be going, I'm melting! Sorry, no. Bad thoughts.
No, wouldn't she swim around going woof because she's a red setter?
Oh, I don't know. But anyway, this wasn't going to be the original opening of the Next Generation part
really?
Of the film.
Really?
No, it wasn't. Originally, we were going to see the Amagosa Observatory under attack by the Romulans.
That would have been awesome.
We would have seen the Romulans! But yet again, they nix the Romulans because they're gits. And even when they finally do it in Nemesis, they don't do it properly. But
no, it's all Remans and bollocks and the bloke. From
What would have been so cool, it would have been all from the point of view that they say there's about 12 crew on board. It would have been from their point of view. I mean, there would have been a bunch of nobodies. It would have been weird. So it's better to have started with the next gen crew. I agree with that.
Yeah, but there's fucking...
The ship stuff is a bit...
Worf gets a hat.
Yeah, it's all very hot, isn't it?
I was just like, oh, fuck off. I mean, that just sounds like one of them, oh, what were they called when we was at school? Janet and John books, Worf gets a hat.
See Worf's hat. Worf's hat is pointy.
Yeah.
Pointy
can,
hat.
Can Worf jump and get the hat?
See Worf jump. Worf jump, Worf. Swim, Worf, swim. Run, Riker, run. Yeah. These sailing ship shots took place, so to say that after a few beers, took place on the Lady Washington, berthed at the Marina del Rey near LA. And the Captain Bird...
You're getting fucking anal about fucking ships, aren't you?
Ships, yeah. Sailing ships.
Oh,
let's get anal about sailing ships.
Oh, fucking hell, no.
Captain Pugwash is going to come on in a minute.
Oh.
Captain Birdseye, who takes over from Troy.
No, I did call him Captain Birdseye.
Yeah, well, that's what he looks like, isn't he? You expected him to start selling frozen peas to the crew, didn't you?
No, fish fingers, actually.
Yeah, oh, his fishy fingers. Anyway, let's not dwell on those.
No.
He takes over from Troy, steering the ship. He's actually the owner of the Lady Washington.
And, okay.
And the wheel is a fake, apparently.
It's a fake!
So, but you get this scene where Picard calls Riker over and he says... just imagine, he talks about how wonderful it is on the open sea. And while we was watching, I'm going, no, it fucking isn't. There's no food. And literally, as I'm saying no food, Riker's going,
no
bad food.
Strict discipline.
Like, I'm just like, yes, I am with Riker on this.
Weevils in the biscuits.
Oh, don't. I found weevils in our flour once.
Oh, you did, didn't you? That was seriously old flour, wasn't it?
It was.
We did not cook with it, needless to say.
No.
It was crawling.
They were black and it was manky.
Life on the ocean wave, life on the rolling sea. Na 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 na. We both some bungle and meat. Sorry. Gone to a rainbow place now. Oh dear.
Do 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 do. Rainbow. Up above the
street. Yeah, we don't need to dwell. Bloody rainbow.
Anyway, Picard gets a message to its computer Arch, and he's visibly upset, and Troy notices. And then that's when you get Captain Birdseye taking the wheel. And then there's a distress call, which our daughter has managed to name Red Albert because she misread it. So from now on, it's not Red Alert, it's Red Albert. So it's Red Albert.
And we get to see both the external of the Enterprise D, which, you wouldn't expect.
Yeah, no, I like the Enterprise D.
Good. And this one's a spruced up, the original huge model they used. They got that out of mothballs, but they've not used it since Best of Both Worlds. And they spruced it up for the film with extra lighting and stuff, so it look a bit and more detailing, because obviously you see more on the big screen.
It's sparkly.
And likewise, they went to town on the sets as well. The Enterprise D's bridge has been altered.
Yes, unfortunately, Worf now has a seat, and it just looks like he's having a boo.
Yes, when he's squatted down behind this tactical position, it doesn't look right.
Worf, fire torpedoes. Yeah. No. No, bad and wrong. Oh, bad and wrong, no.
Squatting chair.
No.
Also, along the sides, there are now ramps, and there are steps up to the command area, which is bizarre. And either side of the ramps, we've got extra consoles that weren't there before.
With nasty swivel stools.
Yes. We've now got working monitors, and before it was static displays. Yeah. But these are actual physical screens now. We've got a new captain's chair, because some bugger nicked the other one. Literally, as they just
really?
Before they were going to film. Yes. Somebody walked out with the captain. How did they let that happen? That's bizarre. So I had to quickly mock up a new one, which wasn't too different to the old one. And the lighting is probably the biggest difference.
It's from Drew. I've got it written in here somewhere. From Drew and Tracy's feedback to the latest Black Dog. What did they call it? Pisso vision.
Yeah, sometimes the ones in 10 forward.
Yeah.
They're all brown.
No, well, it's sort of brown, yellow. It's pisso vision,
yeah.
Isn't it?
There's a, yeah, I'll comment on it. But sometimes the dimmed lighting looks good. It does on the bridge. Other times, yeah, the 10 forward pisso vision is not good.
No. Pile of wank. So, the distress call is the observatory being attacked.
It's a brand new model, this, by the way.
It'll
be reused in Deep Space Nine's third season, so we'll get to see this again quite soon.
Because I wondered if it was like a rejig of the Argus Array.
No, this is a brand new model.
Oh, okay.
We don't see much of it, though, really.
No. There are 19 dead. Picard gets Riker to begin an investigation.
And now it's time for Who's at the... Ensign J! Hey! Ensign J's back of the corn.
Who's that, then?
Well, we saw her not as much as Ensign Gates. She's probably like the second most regular con officer.
Okay.
And sometimes in other places in the ship. So at least I would have preferred Ensign Gates, I must admit, because I've been very attached to her. But Ensign J will do at a push.
Fine. Anyway.
We should be pleased to hear that.
Picard gets Riker to begin an investigation and grouches at him. And Troy is concerned. But actually, at this point, Picard is doing the right thing. He's just suffered a bereavement. And he's getting Riker to do everything because then that's the right thing to do.
It is the right thing to do, but I think he should have done it slightly more clearly and said, "I'm stepping down from active duty Yeah. You're in charge now, and gone to his quarters.
Yeah.
I think is what he should have done, but never mind. Oh, by the way, we get the new com badges debuting here, although admittedly we jumped the gun slightly in starting season 3 of Deep Space Nine, where they also feature, but this is the first time we see them officially.
Now, here's the thing, right? In universe,
yeah.
Why would they change the com badge?
That's an interesting question. I suppose you could argue if they upgraded the technology, they may have thought we may as well change the design while we're at it.
Did they all have to do it? Did they all get a message that said that you're currently using com badge 7 and here's a free upgrade to com badge 10?
Possibly. I wish they'd done the same thing with the pissing uniforms. But anyway, I have ranted before about the uniforms. So I'm not going to go over old ground here. But let's suffice to say, it makes no bloody sense. Originally, they got a new design of uniform that they were going to use for this film, rather like they did for First Contact. It wasn't that different to the next-gen uniform. But then they realised, well, this is where it gets a bit murky. Either they decided that they wanted to keep some more continuity with the TV series and decided not to use the new uniforms for that reason, or the new uniforms had a visible panty line. Depends who you believe online.
Ooh.
But they got as far as producing the figures, of which I've got one of them. I've got the Dr. Crusher figure from Generations, and she's wearing the new design of uniform they never used, which is all rather bizarre. So instead we get this deeply unsatisfying mix and inconsistent mix of Next Gen and Deep Space Nine uniforms.
Including Riker's not even bloody fitting him.
Oh, I know. It's Avery Brooks's, apparently. Avery Brooks is clearly not as tall as Jonathan Frakes.
No, it's nothing to do with height. It's to do with the fact that Avery Brooks isn't a lard arse.
Well, it's partly that, part of the length of his arms. So that's the problem. His sleeves are down to his elbows.
No, he rolled them up. If you look, he's
he's rolled them up a bit, but they're still not long enough. And the other thing is that people have argued, oh, well, it's a gradual changeover from one to the other. But no, that doesn't
make any sense when you've got replicator technology.
Because Picard changes from Next Gen to Deep Space Nine to Next Gen at the end.
Yeah.
No sense.
No. And
I said we wouldn't dwell on it.
It's just one of the other things that makes me cross about the movie. Anyway.
Yeah, that's definitely another black mark against it.
There are about 17. Right.
Not that many.
Yes, there are.
Okay, so far, Soren Lorenson isn't great.
No.
I agree with that. The fact that they included some but not all of the original crew, not a good move.
Yep.
I agree. And the whole costume thing, I completely agree with that as well. So we've got 3 so far.
Yeah. There'll be more.
There will be, but I'm not going to be agreeing with all of them.
Fine. Oh, we got the continuity with the Borg. That's 4.
Yeah, but that's not a biggie.
No, it's enough. 4.
3.5.
4!
You play golf now.
Golf isn't 4, cricket's 4.
And hit the ball.
Yes, that's
correct. You can hit a 4 in cricket, but in golf you yell 4 before hitting the ball.
Do you?
Yes.
Why?
I don't know, it's tradition. Don't ask me. Carry on.
Anyway.
Let's not argue about golf, we've got plenty of other things to argue about.
I think
it's going to be a long night.
Yeah, I think what it is just that I'd rather talk about almost anything than the actual movie, so having a row about golf is preferable. Anyway. They're on the observatory, and the blaster pattern is either Romulan, Breen, or Klingon.
Nice of Breen to get another mention.
It's nice. Cool. No, probably shouldn't say that.
We will be meeting the Breen.
Leave it at that. Yes, thank you. And they find a survivor, and it's Soren Lorenson.
Mm-hmm.
They also find a dead Romulan, and the green blood is a nice little touch.
Mm-hmm.
But seeing live Romulans would have been better. So that's another black mark. So that's 5.
No, but anyway, carry on.
So then you have Geordi. This is 6 in my book. You have Geordi lecturing Data on why his funny practical joke wasn't funny when it was funny. Geordi's wrong. Fuck the fuck off. Data is looking at his emotion chip, which is completely different to the emotion
chip. George! Now, admittedly, they had to make it bigger, I suppose, for the big screen. But even so, it's absolutely huge compared to the one we saw in Descent. Apparently, I don't know whether to believe this or not, but apparently it's apart from an old Zoid kit.
What's a Zoid?
You don't remember the Zoids?
No.
The small ones are wind-up, the big ones are battery-powered, and they were like dinosaurs.
Really?
They were a bit like Transformers, but they didn't transform. They were kits that you assembled, fairly basic. You know, they weren't as complicated as Lego. And as I say, some were wind-up ones, the cheaper kits, and some of them were battery-powered. You
no
really
idea.
Don't remember the Zoids?
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Oh, God, I feel old.
Sorry, I just... No.
Back in the day when I used to read Transformers and Zoids comic. God.
No idea, sorry. Not a clue.
On the other hand, it's clearly hanging from a piece of string. Yeah. Blatantly.
Anyway.
They've got a movie budget and they hang something from a piece of string and show it close up.
And the reason why this for me is one of the black marks is because what might have just been an aside you could brush off as Geordie having a shit sense of humour becomes a key plot point. Because what happens is Data looks at the emotion chip and says if he did the wrong thing with Crusher when he didn't because it was funny, and he doesn't understand humour, which he certainly does better than fucking Geordie, then he needs to put the emotion chip in. Now, if the practical joke that was funny that he's told isn't funny,
overanalyzing this now at this point.
If it didn't lead to a key plot point, it wouldn't bother me as much. It's the fact that he's been told and he believes that he's done the wrong thing pushing Crusher into the water when it was funny. And that's why he puts the emotion chip in. And that's why, for me, this counts as another black mark. I'm on 7.
Well, I'm on, I think, 3 or 4. I've lost count already.
Yeah, but I'm on 7.
Yeah, it's fine. But this is the whole... We are going to diverge on this.
What I'm saying is, if it was just a brief moment as part of the shit ritual that needn't have happened, it wouldn't bother me anything like as much as it does, because it bothers me because it leads to this key plot point.
Mm-hmm.
That's why it bothers me as much as it does, is my point. Mm-hmm. Right. Anyway, don't you hurry me up. I didn't spend fucking ages talking about the fucking sets of the fucking Enterprise. I didn't do fucking, sailing ship. Let's get anal about fucking sailing ships. Or any of that bloody
don't, you'll maybe use Rod Stewart at this rate.
What?
We are sailing.
Oh, what the fuck?
We
off?
Are sailing.
No. No. Not Rod Stewart. Data puts the chip in.
Woohoo.
Riker reports back to Picard, who asks him to speak to Starfleet. And again, he's doing the right thing, but he's not giving Riker an explanation as to why.
Do you want some exciting facts at this point?
There is such a thing, is there, as exciting facts to give me at this point?
In the ready room, the fish tank is bigger.
Believe
it. As is the window.
Can I dock points for you being anal? Can
I anal about ready room?
Yes. I mean, for fuck's sake!
And,
are you going to find two other people who are as anal about ready rooms as you are, and then give them a fucking top trump
ready room jury?
A fucking top trump rating system.
A short
system.
Series, but worth doing.
No!
The really weird thing, though, is that when Riker leaves at the end of this scene, door opens, ready room leads straight to the bridge, door opens, complete blackness. It's like, what the feck? Has the lights gone out in the bridge? Has the fuse blown? What's gone on here?
It's very the night odd. Shift.
It's the pitch black night shift, yeah, blimey. God, they're all sitting there with night vision goggles on, I should think.
Night fever, night fever. Sorry, I have to do something. You just got fucking anal about ready rooms.
I've reached new depths.
Yeah. Mariana's Trench.
Yeah. I'm about to get anal about body doubles.
No! No! No!
I am. No!
Which
sounds a lot more dodgy than it is.
Oh, fuck off, no! You are very, very close to a lamping. Just thought I should warn you.
Can we be the first on-air divorce? You can listen to the exact moment where our marriage ended.
I'm going to buy you a set of anal beads.
No!
And I'm going to write on one of them, spaceships. And on another one, I am going to write... sailing ships. And on another one, I'm going to write ready rooms. And on another one, I'm going to write body doubles.
You're not close to being halfway through yet. Let's carry on.
You're the one who fucking brought up anything about fucking ready rooms.
Yes, say it gets worse. Carry on.
Anyway, Soren Lawrenson demands to speak with Picard. And then we get 10 forward, filmed in piss-o-vision.
Yes, and here we see Picard getting directions from a Bolian waiter. Did you notice that?
No.
Yes.
It's good. Vajazzle has a new job.
Vajazzle's been sacked from the barbers and is now working as a waiter in a cocktail bar.
I was working as a waiter in a cocktail bar.
The interesting thing about
when
this...
When I met you.
Hang on, I haven't got to the interesting bit yet.
Oh, really? Is it really interesting? Am I naming another bead? Am I naming another bead at this point?
He's played by Dennis Tracy, who's Patrick Stewart's body double. You'll hear more about him later. So that'll keep you listening, folks.
Fucking hell.
Oh, my head hurts.
That's nothing compared to what your arse is going to be like after this string of beads.
Promises, promises.
Data gets an emotion from a drink. Turns out he thinks he's disgusting, but yet it wants more. So that's the start of S&M Data. Because pain and pleasure are the same thing. Bondage Data.
He's obviously drinking Carling Black Label. Oh, it's disgusting.
Isn't that what they used to... Wasn't that Romulan Ale in Pages? Carling Black Label with green food colouring?
It was, yes. He had a green tongue when he drank too much of it as well.
I think you get that anyway.
I hate lager, and I only drank it because it was called Romulan Ale. If it had been proper ale, I'd have been a lot happier, but never mind.
No.
Anyway, Romulan Ale's blue. Why was it green? Let's not worry about that. It's Pages Bar. Carry on.
Somebody pissed in it. Soren Lawrenson demands to return to the observatory, and that's when you get the line, "Time is the fire in which we burn."
Yes.
And then you get the crazy eyes of crazy.
Yeah. Again, embarrassing uncle time.
Yeah. And he spots Guinan, who notices him. Turns out that the Romulans on the observatory were scanning for trilithium. This is the point where I notice Riker is in a DS9 uniform and wonder why, especially given that it doesn't fit him. Then you have Data in a DS9 uniform laughing at a 7-year-old joke. Geordi's visor spots a door. And so Data reverses the polarity of the neutron flow.
With his arm.
Then Data's emotion chip malfunctions.
Yeah, that whole thing when he does the laughing. Now, I don't know if they used a bit of CG messing around at this point, but the way his smile goes really wide. Well, it's either brilliant face acting from Brent Spiner, and kudos to him for that, or they CG'd it. But I've
or
it
a
looks
combination.
Weird.
Possibly. Where they got him to do, they told him to do that kind of thing.
But that thing when he goes from, you know, laughing so much he's actually in pain, which I was in just a few moments ago, that that was like, oh, that's really good. So, you know, I don't often give kudos to him, but I do for that.
Right. Unless it's fake, in which case you don't. So there's no signal, they can't beam up. Soren Lawrenson attacks, and Data is scared and useless. Then you have Picard looking at photos. With the Enterprise in piss-o-vision again.
Yeah, and the photos aren't the original actors, which is really, really annoying from Family. I mean, nothing like...
No, and it's like...
You get no... Immediately, it kills any emotional connection you may have had with those characters. I mean, it's all right bringing old characters back to kill them. I mean, it's a fairly cheap shot, but okay, if you're going to do that, at least include pictures of the actual actors.
Well, the thing is... Why in that century has he got an album, not a photo frame? We've seen digital photo
That's
frames.
That's true, actually. He should be looking at one of his pads, shouldn't he?
Yeah.
But he's got a physical picture album on paper, hasn't he?
And I'm not telling... Not only that, it's like a scrapbook, and they're mounted badly. And, like, when our daughter was 5, she could scrapbook better than that.
That's not a thing anymore. It was a thing for a while, wasn't it, scrapbooking? But...
Still is in America. In this country, it's not so big, but it has been big in America for a long time and still is there. But it's just like, he should be looking at a digital photo frame pad thing, and if he'd done that, they could have used stills from Family.
They could have done, couldn't they? Except, of course, the one reason why they don't, for Rene anyway, is that he appears later on, played by, and they couldn't use the same actor as they had back in Family because that was, what, 3 years ago.
Then you have Rene is as close as he could get to having a child of his own. So what happened to I don't like children? He doesn't want a child of his own. He never did. He never said he wanted to. He doesn't fucking like children. So where is all this coming from? Oh, I know, it's script reasons. Doesn't fit at all with the character of Picard at any point in the entire series of Next Generation at all.
Well, the only thing that could have fitted was that he did have a family in Inner Light, so they could have made a reference to that.
But they didn't.
But they didn't.
No, another black mark.
Yeah, it doesn't bother me.
Bothers me a lot.
The only thing that bothers me is the fact, as I say, the fact that it's clearly not the same actors. But let's...
Well, that also bothers me. I could make that 9, but I was making it 8 for the scene. Then you have the star is going kablooey. Probe has been fired. There's going to be a level 12 shockwave because a probe has been fired from the observatory into the sun.
It's an impressive looking shockwave, it has to be said.
Yeah. On the observatory, you've got Soren beams down and he and the Duras sisters nick Geordie. And Riker and Worf are there, but they can't do anything. And there's a bird of prey decloaking. It's Los Rebator, yay!
Now, mostly, unfortunately, it's stock footage that's used for the bird of prey, which is rather disappointing. But the set inside is quite good, isn't it? The bridge set.
Yes. I like the periscope.
Well, that's from Star Trek V.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that gunning tower, which is also used in Star Trek VI as well. So it's got good pedigree when it comes to the movies. But the really interesting thing about this Klingon Bird of Prey's bridge, 2 captain's chairs.
For the sisters.
Yeah. Really nice, that. It's like, you know, not one above the other or anything. They're just 2 captain's chairs. Excellent.
Yep.
Also, we got the helm officer aboard this unnamed Bird of Prey, which is a bit annoying. They should have given it a name. He's played by Brian Thompson, who was Clagg in A Matter of Honour.
Clagg, I recognise.
Yeah,
him.
The dude that was helping Riker out.
Yes.
His third officer.
Yeah.
And he was also the Dozy in Glartu in Rules of Acquisition, which we saw recently. And he'll return as a Jem'Hadar. And he's also Shao Kahn in Mortal Kombat Annihilation.
On the Enterprise,
see Michael Mack, who plays Ensign Hayes at Tactical, who was earlier seen as Cyril, the Romulan, in Season 7's The Beggars. You're not interested, are you?
No.
Oh, shut up then.
Yes. On the Enterprise, we are finding out about Soren Lorenzen. And Picard is in Deep Space Nine uniform for no reason.
Yeah, it doesn't suit him either.
No. He goes to see Guinan, who talks about the Nexus.
Yeah, and apparently Whoopi Goldberg had a hand in designing Guinan's quarters. She clearly likes her candles, doesn't she? Blooming heck.
Yeah, and she's got a picture that looks like one of those ones that you ought to be able to flip it upside down and let the sand all move.
It probably is one of those.
Then you have a scene with Soren teasing Geordie about his visor, saying Geordie isn't normal. And then you get some of the most shitty dialogue since George Lucas, where Soren says that he's Elorian, and he says, "Some people call us a race of listeners. We listen." No shit, Sherlock. If you do listening, maybe that's why they call you listeners.
Well, the reason why this doesn't work quite so well was originally the scene was longer and he tortured Geordie. They cut that out. And he inserted nanoprobes into his heart, which is referenced in dialogue later on when he says that his heart wasn't in it to the Jura sisters. And also Crusher says that she's removed the nanoprobes, but isn't mentioned here when it should have been, really.
Okay, fine. Anyway, it's shit dialogue and bad acting and I don't like it.
It is bad acting, yeah.
I mean,
Soren counts against this film, I don't argue with that.
It doesn't count as an extra point because it's a point we've already made.
Yes.
It's just we're seeing the same point again.
Yes.
Fine. Right. Now, this I don't get, right? Data's chip has fused, so it can't be removed, the emotion chip. Bearing in mind, this is the guy who has taken the Enterprise over in order to go and see his dad and shit. What the fuck is Crusher doing, passing him as fit for duty with a fused emotion chip he can't cope with?
You may well ask. Yeah. But he seems to be functioning mostly...
ish.
Once Picard tells him to pull his socks up, basically.
Yeah. Just bearing in mind he's passed within the series.
Yeah, yeah, you'd have thought they'd have been a bit more suspicious of him, but no, apparently he's okay. And it turns out he is. He just swears a lot more now.
Right. Anyway, they're in stellar cartography, which looks a lot better than it used to.
It does, doesn't it? This is one of the major undertakings for this film, a new set for stellar cartography. Originally, it was going to be a free-floor set built as a sphere.
Mm-hmm.
But budget meant it ended up as a sort of smaller cylindrical set to save costs. It always reminds me of Cerebo
from
the X-Men films, because you've got that platform out to the round bit. But there we are. That and Patrick Stewart, of course.
Yes.
And I do love the way they do it, so that they've got the graphics changing to explain the plot. If you're going to do a plot dump, this is the way to do it. I mean, obviously, they never could have afforded this. This would have been a scene around the Ouchie Table Ouchie, the original series.
Yeah.
Whereas this is a lot better way of doing it. So I think kudos for this scene.
Yeah. Data is full of remorse that he didn't save Geordie. Well, if he's only just started laughing now about a 7-year-old joke, why the fuck is he not emotional about the catch-up from what he did to Geordie in Descent?
Okay.
Then we've got mention of the Bozeman, captained by Fraser, and how it would have to make a course correction. And then Data says he wishes to be deactivated, and Picard basically says, no, deal with it. And then it shows that Sovereign is changing the course of the ribbon to make the ribbon come to him. Because a ship... Now, this is what I don't get. A ship would blow up, but that would put him in the Nexus.
Yes, this is not consistent, because that's how he got in the Nexus before. Exactly. He was on one of the ships that blew up. Bottom line is, ships aren't supposed to be able to get close, but somehow you can if you're standing on a metal platform or summit.
Yeah, point against... No fucking sense.
The whole ribbon thing, which I'm going to group all together, including the when does one leap out thing, all counts as a point against.
Yeah, right. So I'm on 10 and you're on 4.
Yeah, I think so.
Right. So anyway, they've worked out that they need to go to Viridian 3, and he's going to destroy, by moving the ribbon, he'll destroy the whole system, including 230 million people in a pre-industrial civilization on an inhabited planet nearby.
That's a lot of Mitchells.
Yeah. But then I just started getting excited about Bator's armour.
Oh, yes. Lurser and Bator have never looked so good, have they? No. I mean, you know, on the big screen.
Well, it's not just that, but the way, when they appear on the view screen, it's kind of like from the boobs up.
The way
they've, like, chosen their shot, haven't they?
They were meant for the big screen, that's all I'm saying.
And the thing is, the boob hole, the peep hole in the armour is there on their ship for the blokes. You just get to see a little bit of chest hair.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's not woman's armour, if that makes sense. The design is the same. It's just either you have the assets to fill it or you don't.
Mm. And this scene I quite like with Sorin, I must admit. This does give him some intelligence.
Yes.
Because he's whilst he's handing the information over, it's decrypted.
Yeah.
Or encrypted, I should say. And he's not going to send the decryption code until he's got
what he wants.
What he wants. So that's sensible. He knows you can't trust the Jura sisters, and let's face it, you can't. So
I love the whole scene about, you know, he spacks her and she puts the blood on his mouth and says, I hope for your sake you're initiating a mating ritual.
Well, who wouldn't? And Bator clearly says they're no match to the Enterprise D as well, which is pays off later on. That's an important plot point. It's one of the things people have against this film. But she does say, in their antique old Bird of Prey, they are no match for the Enterprise D.
No, that's why they need Geordi's Wiser to do stuff.
Exactly.
Yes. Anyway, Picard agrees a prisoner exchange with the Jura sisters, him for Geordi, but on the understanding that he can beam down to the planet first to talk with Sorin. So I don't understand why they agree to this.
No, it makes no sense, does it? Because they say, oh, we'd make a better hostage, which is true, but then they would make a better hostage if he beamed over to their ship, not if they beamed
him down
the planet.
To the planet, because then the other ship could beam him off the planet, and it makes no sense.
Flaky plot point.
Not connected with the ribbon.
To be fair, they have shown themselves in the past to not be the most intelligent of Klingons.
Silence the child or send him away.
But, yeah, no, that's another mark against.
Oh, not for me, but anyway.
I'm on 11. So, you've got Picard who beams down to Viridian 3, and then I'm on 11, but you can take over and I can drink beer.
Yeah, I mean, the only thing worth mentioning at this point is that Geordi gets beamed over to the Enterprise D.
And collapses,
and Crusher and Ogawa appear.
I didn't spot Ogawa.
Yes, Ogawa's in this, which is nice. Okay, second half of the movie. Picard beams down to Viridian 3, which is in reality the Valley of Fire, which I've been to a few times when I've had a curry. It's a fantastic setting for an alien planet, though. I mean, it looks brilliant. Picard tries getting to Sorin, but he's surrounded by a 1.21 gigawatt force field. Sorry, a 50 gigawatt force field, I think they say, but, you know, had to be done. On the Bird of Prey, they're now seeing through Geordi's visor, and I love Bator's reaction to Crusher. Sorin's motivation is explored, at least. He's determined to get back to the Nexus at the cost of entire star systems if needs be. But ultimately, again, he just comes across as a slightly mad uncle professor guy. Not the most interesting of characters. Compared to Lurs and Bator, if they'd been the primary villains, scoring a lot more higher.
Yeah.
And the film comes alive any time they're on screen, it has to be said. It's particularly when Bator complains that Geordi does never seem to go to engineering.
I love it.
And apparently she watched him bathe.
Oh.
Who were. Then we've got this nonsense about Data using the controls to play a tune, which is just silly.
Life forms.
That annoys me.
One
of my black marks is data throughout most of this film.
Yeah.
And data stroke Brent Spiner at Aspizza.
Yeah.
Lursa pushes her crew out of the way to see the shield frequencies of the Enterprise, which is lovely.
Yeah.
I love the way she dominates those hulking male Klingons. Yeah.
I love the fact that at one point, one of them actually calls her mistress as well.
Yes.
It's like, you know you're a dog on a lead.
Yeah. So, by the way, this explains how this old bird of prey manages to defeat the Enterprise so easily. They know the shield frequencies. They use Geordi's visor. As soon as they find them out, they use them. They shoot straight through the shields and destroy the Enterprise. And without shields, the ship's incredibly vulnerable.
Yep.
So that explains that one.
Yeah. If you play attack wing
and you've got no shields, you're doomed.
Yeah, it's straight to hull points.
Yes. And it does take a few shots before it takes effect. But the fact is, those few shots target the vulnerable system, so that's fine.
Yes.
And Beitel practically orgasms as she fires the photons.
I love it. She pulls, and also she's got the really phallic turret thing. She pulls it down with a big grin on her face towards her nether regions, going,
On board the Enterprise, the con officer goes down. And now it's time for Who's at the Deanna. More of which later. Worf is an unsurprising expert of birds of prey, knowing it's a G-12, a class retired from service, due to defective plasma coils. And Riker cleverly makes use of this to get the sisters' vessel to cloak, rendering their shields inoperable.
Yep.
I wonder if his time on the Bird of Prey in Matter of Honour proved helpful as well.
Possibly, yes.
He orders Worf to fire a full spread of photons, but Worf only fires one, because he's badass, and it does the trick. And we get a final close-up of the sisters before their bird of prey is destroyed, which is sadly stock footage from Star Trek VI. Cheapskates! And goodbye, sisters. Apparently they were going to turn up later on in the film. They were somehow going to get to escape pods or some such rubbish and go down on the planet and there'd be a dust-up or something. Just as well they didn't. I think this is quite a good send-off for them, really. Then we get the crappy Data yes thing, which is just naff, I'm sorry.
Oh, yeah. So Data is another black mark, so I'm on 12.
Well, again, this counts towards Data, Brent Spiner. That's one point.
A bit like the emotion. Well, no, the emotion chip thing and the humour is George's fault, so no, I am on 12. You're still on the same number.
Yeah. Picard Connolly finds a hole in the shield wall. Sorin knows he's trying something, but stupidly doesn't shoot the captain. In engineering, for old time's sake, we have a coolant leak and a Geordi roll. Hey! Logically, Deanna is put in charge of the evacuation necessary for the saucer set, although you'd think she'd have a handsaw piloting the ship at this point, but there you are. She can multitask, clearly. And what a surprise! A bunch of kids have been left to fend for themselves.
I know.
Completely in continuity with the TV series.
Yeah, and one of them is son of a Jazzle.
Yes, it's a bowling kid. It's left to Geordi to rescue them. At one point, you think Geordi's going to be forced to go back for the girl's teddy as well. It's like Alien all over again. Don't go back for the cat.
No.
Don't go back for the teddy. We get our first saucer set since Best of Both Worlds, would you believe? And you can tell they haven't done it in a while because there appears to be flakes of rust breaking off as the separation happens. It's weird. Shiny bits come scattering off. The engineering section explodes really dramatically. Yeah. That's a really good effect. And that knocks the saucer into the orbit of Viridian 3. And the fact that the helm controls are offline means there's nothing Deanna can do.
No.
So they're screwed, whoever's at the con. So it doesn't... All those who've been criticising Deanna for crashing the ship, it ain't her fault. If the steering wheel don't work, there is nothing anybody can do.
And this one doesn't have a fucking shitty joystick, is it?
No,
either. Backup.
Yes.
So, no, A, the shockwave has driven the Enterprise there, not Deanna has driven it there.
Yeah.
And B, then helm control goes offline, so there isn't anything she can do. So all your women drivers jokes can just fuck off.
Do not work.
No.
Yeah. On the other hand, we will be criticising Spiner's delivery of the line, oh shit, which is just, it's crap. To crash the saucer section, they built a bigature and literally flew it into the ground. And there's a really good extra about that.
Yeah, it is, yeah.
At one point in the crash, we see folk in 10 forward, which surely is the worst place to be.
Not clever. Well, no, unless you're like, if I'm dying, I'm dying drunk.
In the bar.
Yeah.
Despite the lack of seatbelts, everybody seems to survive. And also the seats go flying forwards. I mean, how unsafe is this ship? I like the fact that you can see daylight through the thing at the top of the bridge, though. That's nice. Meanwhile, Picard fights Sorin.
Fight, 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 fight!
But he gets slugged to the ground before he can stop the launch of the missile in Viridian Sun. We get some nice effects at this point, showing its destruction, including the lighting going all dim, and Viridian 3 getting blasted to pieces, and the saucer section exploding. Mm. So, all brilliant effects, given their due. And exits Sorin into the ribbon, and handily for the purposes of plot, Picard too. It does seem somewhat underwhelming that Picard wasn't able to stop Sorin on his own. It's not like he was... If it had been Sorin and a bunch of Klingon guards, fair enough, but it's a bit disappointing that, you know, Picard fails to stop him. But there we are. It would rather stop the plot in its tracks.
Yeah, I know, but even so, it's still sort of, yeah.
Then things get very cack. Up until now, unlike you, I've been enjoying this film, okay? There's one or two not-so-good things about it, but generally, I'm happy with it. Right up until this point. As Picard wakes up on the merry-go-round, which is inexplicably part of the world's chintziest Christmas-decorated house.
It's all fucking Victoriana.
His wife and his kids are dressed in as Dickensian knobs for no particular reason. René is back from the dead, except he's played by some other actor. And we get a whole, René? Papa? Nicole? What the hell? It's nightmarish. It's not dreamlike. You'd have thought Picard had more taste than this. It's basically Christmas in Heaven from The Meaning of Life. It's Christmas in Heaven. Hip, 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 hooray. Every single day is Christmas Day.
Oh, it's worse than that. And it's just like, you know, this is, as far as I'm concerned, this is the best contraceptive ever.
Yeah, this would put you off kids for life, wouldn't it?
Terrible.
Oh, he's snapped out of it by a light reflected in a bauble, and Guinan, who is an echo of the person he knows. Oh, yeah, right.
That makes no fucking sense. How can she be in the Nexus?
Even Picard says this isn't right. Well, you're not wrong.
No.
That's not right.
Oh.
No, it's all shut up, that's why. Another black mark. Doesn't make any fucking sense.
This is a definite black mark, and worse, of course, is the consequences later on. Apparently he can leave anywhere, anytime.
So he should leave before the, whatever it is, observatory.
Well,
attacked.
As Annie has pointed out, why the hell does he not leave at the point when, you know, Sorin is recovered from the wreckage, and then they can stick him straight in the brig and be done with it? But no, they have to leave at the dramatic point where they can beat him up. Now, on the commentary, Ron Moore tries explaining this, because he's realised the problem, that Picard could come back at any point, and earlier is better than, you know, the last minute, which is what they do. But apparently, he thought that Picard was trying to avoid undue tampering with the timeline. But he admits that's a feeble excuse.
Cheers.
Feeble.
Feeble.
Picard finds Kirk chopping logs. Euphemism.
Kirk says, do you smell something burning?
Have you got having a stroke? Kirk's cabin was a real home, which they added a new kitchen and staircase for. And the dog was named after a recently departed pooch belonging to Shatner, which is quite sweet. Oh. Then Kirk beats his eggs. Euphemism! Admittedly, the line, who am I to argue with history, is a cool line. I like that one. But it's not until Kirk realises that he's in a place with no threat that he, you know, recognises that the Nexus isn't for him. Which is true to his character, to be fair. I mean, right back to Star Trek V, that classic, where he loved climbing mountains.
Captain Kirk is climbing a mountain. Why is he climbing a mountain? Captain Kirk is climbing a mountain. Why is he climbing a mountain? Captain Kirk is climbing a mountain. Why is he climbing a mountain? Captain Kirk is climbing a mountain. Why is he climbing a mountain?
Because he knows, you know, it's all about living life to its fullest. That's what it's all about. So that's
He's
fair
an
enough.
Adrenaline junkie.
He is, basically, yeah. And we get that lovely line, which is very, very true.
Captain of the Enterprise.
That's right.
Close to retirement?
I'm not planning on it.
Let me tell you something. Don't. Don't let them promote you. Don't let them transfer you. Don't let them do anything that takes you off the bridge of that ship, because while you're there, you can make a difference.
Come back with me. Help me stop Sorin. Make a difference again.
Who am I to argue with the captain of the Enterprise?
Which, for me, justifies the appearance of Kirk in the movie. It doesn't justify the other original series actors, but it justifies the excitement of having Kirk in the movie. Just that scene between him and Patrick Stewart is really cool.
No, not necessary.
It is for me, but there you are.
I don't like Kirk.
I know you don't, so therefore you don't like this. It is not a mark against it for me. We get to see the Enterprise crash all over again, so they get their money's worth from those effects. And this time, of course, it's two captains to stop Sorin, which feels like it ought to be overkill, really.
Yeah.
I mean, again, if the Jura sisters were a bunch of heavy Klingons had been there, you'd have recognised the need, but no need! You get the bit where Kirk punches Sorin off the cliff, which looks like it bloody hurts as he bounces off the cliff face. Wouldn't have wanted to have been that stunt man. There's some business where Sorin's control pad gets dropped, leading to Kirk having to get it from the metal
bridge.
Oh, and
it's just like, has it got super glue on it or something? Fallen off.
And then Sorin blasts the bridge. And this is the point where we're getting into reshoots, because they realise that the original ending, where Kirk got shot in the back by Sorin, was a tad disappointing. Yeah. Well, what a surprise. I mean, what idiot came up with that idea? But, you know, ultimately what we've ended up with instead is a very much a sort of tab A into slot B approach to drama, which is a wittertainment phrase, I admit. It's an underwhelming climax, it has to be said. And that's the other...
Well, the point, if it's underwhelming, it's not a climax, is it?
Exactly.
It's a missed orgasm.
I wouldn't know. Anyway, ultimately, Sorin isn't a very impressive villain, so why is it taking two legendary captains to beat him? And this whole business about the bridge is just so by the book. Ugh, yeah. No amount of leaps and bounds on shaky gantries can overcome the problem. That said, I do like the fact that Picard gets the brakes put onto the missile. He jams the locking brakes on. That's a nice touch. I like that. And, of course, in the process, Kirk dies on the bridge, which, as Andy's always said, is how fans said they wanted him to go out, but that's not quite what they meant, was it? In effect, he dies under the bridge.
Yeah.
Shatner makes a good fist to his final moments to give him his due with the oh my, his idea apparently, a way of commenting on his last great adventure ahead, so that at least is vaguely satisfying.
So Kirk is finally dead, except in the Nexus where he's still alive
somewhere.
No,
he's not. No, the Nexus has moved off, you see, that whole thing hasn't happened.
No, but... Guinan is somehow in the Nexus or not. So everybody's in the Nexus or not.
Only when the Nexus is brought closer, which it no longer is.
So no, we're not told that anywhere. Guinan is in the Nexus and not in the Nexus, so Shatner
That whole business makes no sense anyway. I'm not going to debate you on that, okay? Then we get an aerial shot of Picard standing over Kirk's way too small grave. There's no way Shatner's under those few boulders, I'm sorry. No. Not unless there's a huge crevasse underneath that he's lying in. And it's not Patrick Stewart either when you get the aerial shot.
Really?
But he's standing. Dennis Tracy, I told you he'd come up again.
Uh-huh.
Standing watch.
No.
We get to see now we're on to spaceships. The shuttle model from Star Trek V, renamed from Galileo to Hawking this time, as it comes down to rescue Picard. And then there are loads of shuttles on the saucer section, including the executive shuttle from Star Trek VI. And the crew members we see on the saucer section are ILM FX crew, including legend John Knoll.
Legend who?
John Knoll, a legendary ILM FX person.
Why is he legendary? What did he do?
Because he's really good. He did like Star Wars and stuff.
Uh-huh.
Yes, and he did this.
Right.
Then we get that awful cringe-worthy scene with Data boasting he can control his emotions before finding Spot.
And there's all these yellow drums around, okay, that say danger and seem to have a radioactive symbol on them.
Yeah.
Why are they still fucking intact?
Oh, I don't know. And Spiner was no fan of cats either, so he hated this scene, apparently. Said he would prefer to have found Geordi.
Mm.
And as our son pointed out, at this point he cries, which makes his makeup run. And so we got the immortal line, "His tears look like weed." Oh, God, we laughed for a good 10 minutes after
that. We did, yes.
Because there's nothing that makes you laugh like a reference to Wii. I hope iTunes is going to let us have that.
Yes, I think so. But it's true. His makeup runs and his tears are yellow and his tears look like Wii.
Picard's going through the rubble with Riker and finds his priceless one-of-a-kind curler Niskos from the chase, which he just throws back in the rubble.
Another black mark.
Nice. Not enough for a black mark for me, but yeah, not good.
No, not
Riker expresses his disappointment to not becoming the captain of the Enterprise, which is a pretty stupid career plan, isn't it?
Yeah, twat.
Considering he's hardly covered himself with glory over the years. We get my favourite shot of the film, featuring the USS Farragut, a nebula class, named after a ship in the original series where Kirk served as navigator. This nebula will be later listed as destroyed in Deep Space Nine, but there's also an Excelsior class Farragut in Deep Space Nine Season 7, so the name was kept.
Mm-hmm.
And the origins of the name are the in the US Navy, class of destroyers post-World War One. You're pleased to hear that, aren't you?
Mm.
We also see a Miranda-class and an Oberth looking tiny in comparison with the Nebula, which is a nice bit of scale work there. Splendid. So there we are. Following filming, all the old Enterprise-D sets were struck to make space for Voyager sets.
Mm.
Aboo!
The space spoon.
The only set that wasn't destroyed, you'll be so pleased to hear, was the observation lounge.
The Nauti table you're out to.
Yeah, which was incorporated into the Enterprise-E. $5 million were spent on those reshoots. The scene where Kirk dies, so his end wouldn't have been shot in the back. Or shot in the end, I'm not sure which. And apparently there's some more bits of Christmas scenes as well. Let's not dwell on that, though. The film debuted at number one at the US box office, though, and made a respectable $118 million worldwide, having cost a mere $35 million. Critical reaction was mixed, however. Roger Ebert criticised it for being undone by its narcissism.
Yep.
And gave it 2 out of 5 stars. And it has a 47% rating on Rotten Tomatoes, he says, feeling like he's on the Black Dog. Certainly not a popular film with everybody.
No.
No.
I said, just as a ballpark figure at the start, that I thought I had about 17 black marks. It's actually turned out to be 15 black marks.
Yeah. Whereas I have about 5, I think. Yeah. And ultimately, for an odd number Trek film, that's pretty good going.
From your point of view, 5 is, yes. 15 is not.
No, ma'am.
No. This is just a massive fucking pile of wank.
It's not that bad.
No, it is that bad.
It really isn't.
Yes, it is. Because it fucks with the continuity of what's gone before, the series it's supposed to be celebrating. It fucks with the continuity of Next Gen. It fucks around with Deep Space Nine uniforms for no reason. So it's also fucking up the series that it's one of its successors. It fucks around seriously with the character of Picard in ways that make me very, very angry. Picard doesn't like children. He doesn't want children. And Picard loves archaeology. And there's no fucking way he's going to chuck that over his shoulder. Just no. Fucks around with the best, one of the best, most important characters that made Next Generation. Fucks around with that. No. Destroys the Enterprise-D. Yeah, thanks for that. Fuck the fuck off. Right? Romulans are sort of hinted at and there's a dead one and they don't appear. Fuck the fuck off. You get a shitty villain who can't act when you've also got the Dura sisters. So you can kind of see what it could have been and it wasn't.
Yeah. Fuck. Here's what you could have won.
Yeah, right. Fuck the fuck off. The Nexus, fuck the fuck off. Plot doesn't make any sense, fuck the fuck off, because they should have been there earlier and sorted it all out, so, you know, fuck the fuck off. Brent Spiner, fuck the fuck off. Geordi no longer understands humour, and it leads to a key plot point for Data, fuck the fuck off. Pisses all over Star Trek VI, which is my favourite movie, and is the proper sign-off for the original cast.
I have sympathy with that opinion.
The Shat dies and yet doesn't and is forever alive in the fucking Nexus somewhere because of his awesomeness or some other such fucking bollocks. He does, fuck the fuck off!
Later on, apparently he gets reconstructed by the Borg as well.
Yeah.
Don't dwell on that.
No, just...
Will not die! Can we dwell on what's good?
What's good? Bator's cleavage.
Yes, Lursa and Bator are fantastic and fully deserve their place in the movie. Brilliant stuff. The music is brilliant. I love the score.
Apart from at the beginning when it's really dramatic music for a fucking champagne bottle in space for too fucking long.
It's a sort of gentle beginning.
It's not a gentle beginning. It is.
It's wibbly wobbly.
It's piss boring fucking wank.
Again, it was that or Shatner flying in on a parachute.
It didn't need to be fucking either of them. It could have been the same scene, but shorter.
Yeah, you need to get a lot of bottle. What's that from?
Some that fucking milk advert. Yes. What the fuck are you on?
Lovely. Milky, milky. Lion bottle. Lion bottle. And the effects are brilliant. Except for the only thing I would say is it's a slight too much reliance on stock footage, but generally the effects are brilliant.
There's a couple that stick out that don't quite work, but there are some beautiful ones. I would agree with that.
Mostly the acting is good.
Apart from fucking Soren Lawrence. And Brent Spiner.
And those wince-worthy children. Oh. But other than that...
Well, you say good. That, they were probably directed to be wince-worthy. Weren't they? I mean, it's not necessarily the child actors that are at fault. It could have been the directors.
Yeah.
They could have been directed to be utter cunts.
But most, you know, the rest of the Next Gen crew are cool.
Well, Geordi's out of character as well because he lectures Data on not being funny when he's funny.
But he gets to do a Geordi role, so he's completely in character.
That is the rest of it.
I mean, Soren, I will grant you, Soren is underwhelming. And that Christmas scene is just unforgivable.
Oh, fucking
that awful. When I first saw it, that's what I took away from it, was that scene was like stuck in my head. And I could not get it out. And I hated this movie as a result just of that scene. Over time, I've mellowed and I've realised that actually there is much to be enjoyed in this film. There's much to be enjoyed. There are weaknesses. Lots I'm not claiming them. It's a great film.
No.
But for an odd-numbered film, and compared to All Good Things now, this looks actually like a masterwork, to be honest.
No, they're both piles of wank. They're just slightly different fetid jizz tissues.
I disagree. So there we are. That's our disagreement. I think we're going to Thunderdome this one, for those of you who know about the Black Dog, because we have opposing positions. I mean, as I say, I'm not saying this is brilliant, but I am saying this is okay and sometimes unfairly treated.
This is very far from okay. Whereas
she hates its guts.
Yes.
So we're going to take a tally now of everybody else and see what they think. Here we go. Let's start with a mark. Some of the feedback obviously is going to be a bit longer because it's about an entire movie. And that's like, normally we like feedback to be no longer than 5 minutes long. But obviously when you're covering an entire movie like we are tonight, it's fair enough to go over the 5 minutes. Let's find out what the mark made of this.
And the mark writes, Star Trek Generations, or my full comments will be delivered next Tuesday. Nice. Or ominous lines as personal philosophies. Oh, shit. When Star Trek Generations was released in late 1994, Star Trek was at the height of its popularity. Next Gen had wrapped its television run the previous May, still very highly rated. Deep Space Nine was on the air, Voyager was in production, less than 2 months from premiering. Trek was even on the cover of Time magazine. It was the pop cultural apex of Star Trek. Generations was the punctuation mark for that moment. One thing you're forced to face with the opening sequence aboard the Enterprise B is that bringing back original crew members after a perfectly satisfactory send-off at the end of Star Trek VI in the wrong roles was a bad idea. Abso-fucking-lutely. The Enterprise B was the only one of the Enterprises we hadn't seen in a story leading up to Generations, so it seems natural to bridge that Trek history gap in a film that in essence is all about bridging generation gaps.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, Generations is without doubt the literal torch-passing affair it promised to be. It's just that it's not especially a satisfying experience on the whole. It's a bit of a mishmash. A crisis forces the Enterprise B, commanded by Captain Cameron Fye, Captain Harriman, who, like most of the ship, will have his backbone delivered on Tuesday. But hang on, and they're in the Sol system, the heart of both the Federation and Starfleet.
Yeah.
But there's no other ship in range?
Yes, right by Earth. A, what are they doing there in the first place, if they've come from the Delta Quadrant, and B, that literally there's no other ship?
Yeah, so that's an extra black mark. I'm on 16 now, thanks, Mark. It's not exactly leaving Earth very well protected, is it? We jump to Next Gen, where Worf is being promoted in the holodeck of Enterprise D. The setting is a sailboat, named Enterprise, of course. Interesting, one of the inherent drawbacks of essentially relaunching the show as a film series is that the screenwriters had to bring non-followers up to speed. Consider the scene after Worf falls in the water, where Data expresses his confusion to Geordi about what is and isn't funny. The scene would not have to be explained to us on the TV series, and here he seems forced to draw upon the characters as if to say, OK, now we're going to bring all you unfamiliar audience members up to speed. One thing Generations gets right is the scope of its storytelling. Unlike Insurrection, for example, which feels just like another routine TNG episode, the events of Generations take on much more significance than you would see in a typical TV episode. Promoting Worf, giving Data emotions, killing Picard's brother and nephew, killing the Jurass sisters, blowing up and crashing the Enterprise, wiping out entire solar systems, these are the kind of bigger things that should happen in a movie adapted from a TV series. Picard's arc is in theory a good one. No, it isn't. Touching on the whole ageing mortality theme that was made so memorable in Star Trek II. And done so much better. In practice, however, here it's not all that great. I wasn't much moved by the deaths of Picard's brother Robert and nephew René. While Picard has every reason to grieve, I've never been a fan of the crying scene where Picard breaks down. Indeed, it's a scene I've mocked in the past. Patrick Stewart's a fine actor, no doubt, but there's something about this scene that just doesn't work. I think, in a way, we simply don't want to see the captain of the Enterprise sitting in the dark crying. The movie's villain, Dr. Tolian Soran, who's not one of Trek's film's best villains, but he's also not the worst either, they are to come. He's not evil so much as obsessed and unbending in his goals, even if it means destroying entire planets and their populations as a side effect, which I guess qualifies as an evil byproduct. McDowell is good at dispensing ominous lines as personal philosophy, such as, they say time is the fire on which we burn.
Just slightly hammy.
Little more than a little bit. Which points towards his quest against mortality. Later on the planet's surface, Picard and Soran will exchange some worthwhile dialogue about mortality. If there's one constant in the universe, it's death. From an action standpoint, the film tops out with the Enterprise's evacuation to the saucer section and the separation of the ship, the eye-popping destruction of the beloved Enterprise D, half of which explodes and the other half of which crashes.
Yep.
During the evacuation, I always laugh and shake my head at the shot of the girl who loses her teddy bear. Oh, come on.
I know, that is so corny, yeah. Isn't it?
It's further evidence that TNG's concept of civilians on starships that routinely go into battle is, dare we say, fucking stupid.
Yeah.
But the crash sequence is long, loud, intense and exciting.
Yes.
If you're going to blow up and crash a starship, this is the way to do it.
Yeah, I mean, very good point. I mean, thinking of Star Trek 3 when they blew up the movie Enterprise, I mean, that was just amazing the way they did that with the whole saucer section exploding. And to be fair, this is a fair comparison. This if you're going to blow up a ship, this is the way to...
I don't like that they destroyed the Enterprise D, but it's a good...
They did it well, at least.
Yeah, yes. Yeah.
I mean, whether or not it was the right thing to do, it was impressively done.
Yes. On top of that, there's the destruction of the planet itself, which is a chilling image. This is true as well.
Mm-hmm.
This is some pretty good stuff and signifies the film's visceral high point. But this is when things start to misfire. Picard is pulled into the Nexus, leading to the film's most tedious sequence, which everything about the plot is explained to us, often in ways we're unwilling to believe. The overly idyllic Christmas setting with all those cloying kids. I see what they were going for, but on an entertainment...
No, I don't. What were they thinking? Really, what were they thinking at that point?
No.
I know what Picard will be into.
No.
What, really?
No. If you know him from the TV series, no.
No.
Not ever. No.
Not chintz. Dickensian chintz.
Not children ever.
And not just the children, but just the whole... just doesn't fit with his French background.
No, none of it works. He would be on an archaeology dig, discovering something important. Like the things he fucking throws away in the end.
Fair point.
I agree with the Mark here. He says this is exactly what chapter skip on a DVD player was invented for.
Definitely, yes.
Yes.
I think we have skipped this in
the whenever past. We've watched it.
Yeah. Well, not whenever we've watched it, but a few times.
Mark says, the thing that irked me was the fact it physically took a lot of energy to get into the Nexus, like blowing up stars, flying ships through it. Yet when two captains decide to leave, they just ride out on horseback?
Yeah.
Doesn't make any sense. Kirk's death scene is terrible and unnecessary. It's been fun is not a good last line to go out on.
It's not bad. And the... Oh, my. I will give Shatner a bit of stick, but actually, as death scenes go, this isn't bad, I think.
Could have been worse.
Mm.
And then he says, the special edition DVD contains a commentary track that must be one of the best commentary tracks yet. because their comments lend great insight into the strengths and weaknesses in the storyline, yep. and with surprising forthrightness.
Yes, indeed. I mean, that's where you get the whole, yes, we know there's a problem with the Nexus.
Yeah. And he concludes with, the film itself doesn't have much to say. It's more about itself and what happens. On those terms, it's an okay movie. No, it isn't. It's a fucking pile of wank.
Is it interesting? It's an event. Whether it's a decent plot is another matter, but it's an event.
It's a thing that happens.
It's a thing that happens that has some good things about it.
And a lot of crap I hate.
Okay. I think we're putting him in the column against, just about. He tries to see the good side, but I think he's more down on it than I am. Would you agree?
Yeah, more down than you are. I think most people are.
Votes against. Well, I'm hopeful that I might not be the only one that can find some redeeming features in this film.
And there are some redeeming features.
And to be fair, he does say it's better than Bloody Insurrection, which is true. Arguably, I think there's some First Contact and then it nosedived.
First Contact's good.
Thank you for that, Mark.
Thank you.
We also heard from Doreen. Hello, friends. Okay, I'm not in Amory's camp with regards to Generations, but I don't love it either. I guess I'm in the conflicted camp again. I'm going to be counting this towards me. To my amazement,
depends how it goes, ultimately.
To my amazement, this appears to have been a mystery monocle for me. I'm not at all sure that I'd ever seen Generations all the way through before. There are only about three distinct scenes I had any memory of at all. I was generally surprised both times Kurt died, when it looked like everyone else had been killed. But I was expecting some type of reset button, but only because I've seen First Contact and other later films. Okay, this is not a patch on Search for Spock and Wrath of Khan, etc., though I'm much of a fan of the original series, but the classic Trek films are possibly the best of the films, in my opinion.
I think that's probably fair,
Certainly the best films are some of the original ones, yeah. I did not like the music at all. Oh. It was almost as if the music was trying extremely hard to make really mediocre writing into some kind of epic story.
That's certainly true of the opening scene.
The weird sort of mood lighting, either almost natural twilight dawn or Guinan's candlelit quarters, was that a fire hazard? On the Enterprise did not sit right with me.
Me neither, it was pisser vision.
If I actually had to live on the ship, I would probably like it better, but after all these years watching the crew surviving, always in institutionally lit surroundings, this made it feel less like Trek.
Yeah.
Data totally proves that while self-improvement is good, trying to be someone you're not is the worst idea ever. And those tears at the end were just awful.
Yeah, they look like we.
Some would argue pissy. I did not like the belts on the uniforms. Take them away. Ah, it's interesting. It did look at times like they had belts. There weren't belts. It's like a band that goes around the bottom. But yes, it don't look
Frakes' cummerbund really obvious because his beer gut basically starts too high
basically
up.
Basically, that when they're wearing the Deep Space Nine ones, they aren't tailored for the actors.
No.
And they look terrible as a role. And it does sometimes look like they're wearing belts, yeah. And the captain's chair at the beginning on the Enterprise B was awful. Ah, it's not just me that notices these things. That was a crappy captain's chair. The design of the ship had rescued them at the end, which I'm told is a Nebula class, just reminded me of smart cars. Oh, Doreen.
I think you might have offended him.
Okay, there are a few things I liked. Data's stupid wee song about finding life forms whilst being so undata-like was nevertheless really quite funny. Seeing Kirk again and him having a proper scene was quite good. The back of a cereal box pop psychology was sweet if grating at times. She lists that as one of the good points. I love the range of Patrick Stewart's acting that was on show in this film. Yep, Oh, and Troy actually appeared to have empathic powers in this film. That's one of the few plot points about Nemesis that makes some sense. Yeah. But anyway, I'm also told that Patricia Tallman was Gates McFadden's stunt double when Data pushed his crusher in the water.
It's obvious, actually.
Thanks, Doreen. Well, she said she wasn't in your camp, so I'm counting this as a vote towards me. Although some of the things she likes about her are actually some of the things I hate, rather bizarrely. So, yes, I'm counting that as a point in the Peter camp. Oh, yeah. Who we got next? Cheeky Monkey Gin.
And he writes, "Greetings, orgs. I love, love, love this film."
Oh, yes!
What? Are you mental?
No, he's not.
"I can remember seeing it in the cinema on release and couldn't sleep that night. So much going on in my head. Kirk dead! No! He isn't. He's alive somewhere in the Nexus. The Enterprise blown up, well, half blown up. No! I'm pretty sure my adolescent self should have had counselling when the original Enterprise blew up. I'm still not sure I'm over it. The special effects of the warp core explosion and subsequent crash landing of the saucer section were mind-blowing at the time. The scene of Picard and his family enjoying in the Nexus enjoying a Christmas... maybe not.
Of course. I thought he was going to list that as a plus point then.
Well, given that he said, I love this film, I just thought he totally lost the plot, to
well,
be honest. Well,
even I would have... yes.
I always thought it was a shame they couldn't scrape together the whole original cast for a final on-screen reunion. That was Star Trek VI, I hear everybody cry. Yes! Yes, listen to us! Granted, I just feel a full cast handover on celluloid to the Next Generation would have been symbolic and more of a curtain call for the originals. No, it wasn't needed. Anyway, enough what-ifs. I'll have to take solace in my Generation's book, a novel of the film which does feature the full cast. Well, I hope Anne-Marie makes it through the review without getting too angry, drunk or falling asleep. We'll see, I've done all three.
You haven't fallen asleep,
to my knowledge. Well, I had a little nap while you were doing Let's Get Anal About Ready Rooms.
It was a comedy nap, to be fair.
I was actually quite tired. So I think I'm 3 for 3.
He knows you so well.
He does, yes. He says, take care. P.S. I used to love raspberry and strawberry crusher as a boy, grainy bits and all. See?
Ooh.
He's broken. He is broken. The grainy bits and crusher have broken him, and that's why he agrees with you.
Then, nevertheless, a point is a point, and on the basis it ain't going to last, let me just say 3-2. 3-2.
I was taking the piss. I don't think you're actually mental. I just very much disagree with you, but thank you for your feedback.
Okay, so that's our written feedback. We've also had some MP3 feedback. Oh, where to start?
Well, I just read someone who agreed with you.
Mm-hmm.
You can play someone who you think is going to agree with me.
I think it's going to be pretty much everybody on the list from now on inwards. That's why I was celebrating the 3-2.
Okay.
Let's hear from the Argyle Smurf, which is a bit of a surprise, because normally only comments on Deep Space Nine, so this is going to be interesting.
Okay.
Hello, everybody. Damien the Argyle Smurf, and I'm here to talk at you about Generations. And I am standing by what I said last fortnight. I do enjoy this film. Despite the fact having now watched it with a critical eye rather than an entertainment one, it makes no fucking sense. But, you know, it's good Saturday night viewing anyway. I don't care. it's riddled with plot holes, isn't it? It's got issues. But yeah, I do enjoy it anyway. And like I said, I haven't watched it with a critical eye probably ever. And it's something I've been watching since I was young. But, anyway, so we start off with our pre-credit sequence, so to speak, where the history or futures of all of the TOS characters is retconned all to hell, although only three of them, the only three they could afford, which is Kirk, Scotty and Alfred Bester. I'm not going to comment on what they've done to the history, because I don't know much about... I know very, very little about TOS, and only a limited... Well, actually, no, a fair amount about TNG. I just haven't watched it in donkey's years. I do think Shatner's doing well in that opening sequence, though. He does well. He does look annoyed and patronised to a degree. And Tuvok's up there, too, although his ears don't look quite right. But I think it's a reasonable opening bit. I like the little running not till Tuesday gag as much as it's hackneyed. It's well enough done. And you know, they rescue 46 out of 500 or so people from the Nexus, as we later find out, and assumingly the other 450 end up in the Nexus, which leads to the first of the plot holes. But but yeah, so it's very easy to see very early on that Sorin is an absolute mentalist. There's no questioning where the bad guy is in this particular piece. There's no wondering about Moses. He is incredibly two-dimensional. And I understand the concept of going mad because you've been denied something wonderful. Usually it's the love of a beautiful woman or something. But, well, we don't know what his nexus is like. It could be the love of many beautiful women. we've got that running B plot about Data's motion chip. Never liked it. I don't like it at all. It just annoys me. The bit where it is actually necessary, in where it you know hampers Data as a character, it just doesn't seem necessary. It doesn't. It pays off a little bit, I suppose, but and it's character development, which again is done in a really really weird place. You know, you'd think you'd do this 2 seasons ago, let alone now, but there it is. And I find myself thinking he's running around the observatory laughing furiously at I'm wondering, is he laughing at Geordi's joke during the Farpoint mission, or is he just laughing because he saw the entirety of Encounter at Farpoint and just can't he's just laughing at that instead. And after that we get Lursa and Boob Tor back. I mean those two. They're always entertaining for for reasons and stuff. Yeah, like they keep your attention on the screen, or something anyway. But yeah, later on, of course, we get Riker finally gets in the big chair, he gets to command the Enterprise, and he has it for about 20 minutes, and then crashes it into a fucking planet. So you can see why he didn't get that promotion, I guess. And you've got Picard following Kirk around like an annoying little boy in Kirk's idea of heaven, nagging him to try and become... the hero that he, let's face it, already is. And when you've got Picard following Kirk around, reading the plot, it sounds fucking stupid, doesn't it? It just sounds ridiculous. Oh, we've got to go to a place, and there's this guy who wants to blow up something, and it doesn't make any sense. And, okay, why... Okay, why don't we dig a few of these plot holes? I'm afraid I'm going to go over the 5 minutes here, but... I know they've been readily explored, but I'm going to dig out a few of the most annoying plot holes for me. Why don't you just fly into it in a ship? So the ship's going to get destroyed, so what? You're not going to get killed, you're going to wind up in the Nexus. That's what happened to everybody else, including half of Guinan, apparently. So why hasn't he just flown into it in a ship and let that ship be destroyed? What else have we got? Little tiny one, granted, but... they find out that they're going to destroy the Viridian Star because he's in the stellar cartography and he says, what would happen to the course of that thing if he destroyed the Viridian Star? And the computer goes beep and moves the course into the planet. But surely it needs the variable of when the Viridian Star is destroyed. It matters when that's launched, because if it's destroyed, you know, half an hour earlier, then the course change is going to be much more severe and it's going to miss that planet completely the other way. So... how they actually arrive at the final information seems to me a bit of a stretch. And a bit of luck. And then when they go back, why do they go back to when they go back? Why do they go back to just before the rocket is launched? That doesn't make any sense. If you want to go back in time to fix the problem, go back to, like, you know, 4 hours earlier and just knock him the fuck out. Put him in the brig and be done with it. No, I want to go to when we're 2-0 down with 10 minutes to play, please, and try and recover the game from there. They didn't even go back in time far enough to save the teddy bear. That's offensive. I'm just being silly now. But yeah, I don't hate it. The middle lags like heck, and, you know, from the moment at which he wakes up in the Christmas Wonderland or whatever it's meant to be, it just slams a handbrake on this on the entire plot, and it never recovers, which is a shame. Because as a meaningless Saturday night, couple of beers and watch a film kind of film, it's not that bad. Apart from the fact it doesn't make the blindest bit of sense. But it doesn't need to make the blindest bit of sense. Well, we've all watched Transformers, they don't make fucking sense either. Many films don't make the blindest bit of sense when you actually look at them. But yeah. I like also, my brain goes to nasty places, and it's like, he's asking Guinan, this is a Nexus? And Guinan replies, for you, this is what you wanted. I'd love it if she just continued that. In mine, it's just blackjack and hookers and coke, but hey, each to their own, I guess. And then Picard thinks he's breaking into Kirk's bedroom, and then it's a stables instead. And he says, this is not your bedroom. And Kirk says, no, it's better. Think this through. He thought he was going into a room with a presumably hot, naked woman in it. And he went in a stable and found a horse instead and found that better. Do we need a wee chat? Does he need to address some issues? Anyway, I'm wasting your time and I'm very deeply sorry for this. I'm going to go away now. I hope you didn't hate it as much as you thought you would, Ammo. And I hope you didn't your opinion of it didn't drop as much as you feared it might, Peter. And I will speak to you in a fortnight about whatever it is we're doing then. Have a lovely one. Cheerio.
Bye.
Bye.
Thank you, sir. I will never see that scene in the same way. This is better. Stables. Feeding a little horse.
Oh, no. He wants to feel a stallion between his legs, obviously.
Oh, dear. Yes, you're right. The film's great up until the point where Picard wakes up in the Nexus, and then it really does go to pot somewhat. It's got issues.
No shit.
But it's still a vote in my camp, because he generally likes it.
I don't know how! It's he lists all the things that are wrong with it. You know, the fact that they go back to when they're equivalent of 2-0 down with 10 minutes to play.
Yeah, it's good, isn't it? Yes. Okay, I think we're going to go with somebody who definitely is going to agree with
please.
You.
Please!
Let's go with Lee.
Yes.
Hey, one of my co-presenters of Space Doc Jury.
Yeah, we're going to have to... Would he want to do a fucking Ready Room jury?
Jury, I don't know. Yeah, maybe he does. Maybe that's his feedback, talking about the glories of the Ready Room. You just don't know. Let's find out.
Good evening, guys. It's Lee here. I heard you were doing Generations, and so just felt compelled to send the feedback in. And let's just start off with a few things here. Firstly, when Star Trek The Motion Picture came out, it was a film that had to re-establish Star Trek in the popular culture. It had to come out, and after about 10-15 years worth of not actually no new episodes, it had to reintroduce everyone. And so that was part of the reason why it was so ploddy and generally a bit sort of self-congratulatory and a bit up its own arse. Next Generation went off the air to much acclaim and much plaudits and much wailing, and everyone was about, you know, no one wanted to see it go. And within a year, 18 months, something like that, Generations was out. Now, Generations doesn't have to do what the, you know, motion picture does. It's literally hitting the ground running with one of the most popular TV shows still in the public consciousness. So it doesn't need to introduce anyone. It doesn't need to change its tone. It knows exactly what it needs to do. It just needs to give you a big screen adventure. But what does it do? It gives you Captain Kirk having a big screen adventure. And it does it for about 15 to 20 minutes. At which point you have explosions, spaceships, lots of action, things happening, panic, disaster. All the sort of stuff that the Next Generation should be doing. But instead, what happens is, once Kirk's gone and he's blown away and sucked out into the vacuum of space. By the way, liking the fact that you can blow a hole in the Federation ship and it doesn't just vacuum into space. Oh no, we got some magic shield that just goes over the hole. But that's neither here nor there. And so when we get to the Next Generation, what we do is we have a tone shift where everything just sort of stops and slows down and goes and just farts out. And we immediately start with Picard being told that his nephew has died in a fire. Now, I'll be honest with you, it's not the sort of happy, let's just see everyone happy and see the next generation crew that we all know and love. It's not the way to start it. You know, Wrath of Khan wanted to show you all the characters getting old. You know, Search for Spock wanted to see Kirk sort of dealing with Spock's death. But those were continuations of a story. What you got here is you've got, let's introduce everyone. Oh, look, there's a moping, crying, sitting in a piss yellow ready room, in an uncinematic piss yellow ready room, Picard basically having a little weep. And from that point on, oh, pardon me, I'm just hitting the microphone. from that point on, the whole tone of the film is set by that. You see original series stuff, exciting action. Then Next Generation, boring, 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 mopey, mopey, mopey. And it's not helped any further by the fact that they give Data his emotion chip. And essentially, he turns into a whiny bitch. Now, I understand, you know, that he's overwhelmed with emotions, and that's fine. And I understand that, you know, fear and you know, trepidation and all this sort of stuff is everything that they were building up to with the Next Generation. The problem is that they don't really pull it off in here. All they do is they don't introduce the fact that Data is, you know, still a machine. You know, they don't acknowledge that. He just becomes totally human. And so his emotions just utterly overwhelm him. And when they've done it before in Next Generation, in Descent, for example, he does go off the rails a bit. But what happens is he's still aware of what's going on. He's still aware of himself. So this whole thing of, you know, him cowering in a corner when Sauron's firing guns and him, you know, saying, oh, I can't do this thing, I'm having to type some keys in stellar cartography, and oh, it's terrible, 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 I'm overrun with guilt, and I think you should turn me off, and all this sort of thing, it doesn't wash. It just makes him look weak, and it doesn't make you think, oh, what an amazing emotional journey he's on, or anything like that. It just adds to this morose vibe that runs right throughout the rest of the film. And you can see that they're trying very hard to capture that Wrath of Khan, things moving on, life moving on vibe, but they've not earned it. And so when you finally get to the whole point of the story, which is the Nexus and blowing up Viridian, whatever it's called, it's just like, you think, well, okay, fine, but this is all, this feels like a mid-season three or four episode where they're trying to give you a little emotional depth to each and every character, but in the meantime don't really have a story to plot around it, because the Nexus itself is one of those MacGuffins that if you think about it for more than a second or two, it just goes out the window. It's like, okay, so Sauron wants to get back in the Nexus, fine, why doesn't he fly back into Nexus? Oh, he'll rip the ship apart. Okay, but it won't kill him if it comes and rolls over him. So what's it like? How does that work? You know, if you fall into it, you get killed. If you fly into it, you get killed. But if it falls on you, then you don't. Huh? In which case, why doesn't he take a shuttle, just stand in its path and let it roll over him? Similarly, when Picard gets sort of absorbed into the Nexus, he appears in what seems to be the Hallmark Channel, talking about Christmas things. I mean, he almost looks like one of those naff. His house looks almost like one of those really naff adverts for KTEL Records that you used to see in the mid-80s. Sort of Bing Crosby's greatest hits. You can't buy this in the shops. You know, and there's like a piece of tinsel stuck to the lens and a ball in another corner, and everything's covered in lens flare at least 10 years before J.J. Abrams even got hold of a camera. And again, that whole scene is washed from head to foot in this kind of weird pale orangey yellow light, which makes everything feel ugh and flat and boring. And then when you get another sort of weird offshoot with Lursa and Beitor, which I'm sure at this point Pete's probably had a number of crises and probably had to lie down a bit and, you know, maybe take some bromide in his tea. But the thing is, Lursa and Beitor turn up as these nominal villains, but frankly, they are out of it for so long that just pulling them in just feels like what happened was all the writers just went through some flick cards and went, which villains haven't we used? Borg, no, we'll leave that for the next episode, next film. Klingons, well, yeah, we could do Klingons, but what can Klingons? We got, you know, Klingons are our friends now. Oh, what about Lursa and Beitor? You know, was Gowron not available that day? Or Tony Todd, was he busy on Candyman 7 or something? And so when they pull that whole stunt with Geordi and his visor and all that kind of stuff, which, let's be honest, no one would have noticed. Not even Geordi. No one's going to twig that something's going on there. No one's... Oh, he got kidnapped by Sauron. Or Sauron. Or, you know, anyway, Saruman. He gets kidnapped by him. And then immediately it's like, oh, he feels fine. Right, okay, let's send him back into engine room. There's nothing that could possibly go wrong now. It's like, really? Really? How many episodes have we seen this with Romulans doing exactly the same thing? You know, oh, we got hold of Geordi. I know, let's turn him into a walking CCTV camera. So it makes the Enterprise crew seem very inept. And it's all just for plotting sake. It's not really a story. It's just, let's just find a reason to blow the Enterprise up. And that's all the reason that Lursa and Bator are really there for. They don't wrap up any of that Klingon Empire story. They just turn up. They shoot the Enterprise, they blow it up, and it blows them up, and that's the end of it. They might as well have, they could have been Ferengi for all it mattered. And so let's get to the blowing up of the Enterprise. The Enterprise goes down like a bitch. I mean, that's as simple as that. A bird of prey shoots it. Okay, it shoots through the engines, it shoots through the shields, you know, the phasic thing for the shields or whatever it is. And that's fine. But even the old Enterprise, when they were shields down, Wrath of Khan, the Reliant gives them both barrels right across the hull. No, not a problem. But a Galaxy-class ship? Oh, well, did you not know that it was made of toffee and silk paper and a little bit of wood? No, neither did I, but apparently it is. And you can see, it's just to get rid of the Enterprise. The Enterprise, in a wide-angled, you know, 16x9 frame, looks like a stubby box. And you can see, everyone wanted to get rid of it to make the Enterprise E. The Enterprise E looks like it fits in a cinema screen, whereas the Enterprise D looks like it fits on a 4x3 television screen. And so, again, the whole thing just rolls over, this mood just settles over the whole film, that it's just a bit morose and a bit dour and a bit unhelpful. And then you get fucking Kirk come back for no reason, apart from having, from what I can see, a fight with Sauron and having the best gag in geekdom, which is Bridge on the Captain. But apart from Bridge on the Captain, his job is what? To have a fight while Picard has a fight? Right? And the Nexus will allow you to travel to anywhere in the universe and come out at any time in the universe, except... I know, we'll bring us right back to the very point we left. That way we'll have a bit of excitement. Really? A bit of excitement. So you wouldn't just go back to the point where you saw Sauron and go, yeah, see that guy there? See him there? I'm going to punch him in the face, and then I'm going to hide in the cupboard until future me goes into the Nexus. But then even future you wouldn't go into the Nexus if you punched him in the face. I mean, it would just disrupt the timeline and everything would be up in air. But as we know from all Trek, you know, that doesn't matter. So, yeah, Star Trek Generations is a torch passer of the classic proportions. You need to have old hero pass the torch to new hero. But the problem is that new hero, as presented in this thing, is nothing like the hero in a TV show. At this point, he's a morose, boring, self-centered, navel-gazing, whiny but crybaby, and most of his crew are following suit, and his spaceship gets blown up by what could possibly be generously described as bumping into a curb. And so, yeah, it feels a bit like what would later happen to the Firefly with the Serenity film, where they basically resettle the characters back to square one and give you no reason to care. And yeah, for me, Generations is a noble but failed experiment at trying to continue on half a dozen threads from the TV show, none of which needed to be continued on, and all it does is just make it feel like, hey, you remember the original crew? They were having fun in that first 20 minutes, right? The rest of it, nah. They all just sit around and kind of bleat. And it's not good. So, yeah, that's my 10 Pennyworth for Generations. Anyway, sorry it ran long. Keep up the good work, guys, and I'll speak to you soon. Till then, take care. Bye.
Bye. Bye. One in my column.
Yes, I think that's fair to say. It is for free, yes.
Yeah. It starts out all wrong. It's the piss yellow, ready room of weeping, boring mopey TNG.
Yeah, I do agree that's not a great way to...
So that's my 17th point.
...introduce Picard to movie audiences.
No.
When you compare that to how he's in First Contact, where he's also driven.
Yeah.
But he also has a bit of fun as well.
Yeah. In terms of the Enterprise D, have we seen the D in the TV series with its shields down taking a pounding?
I can't think of an instance when we saw it with its shields down. I mean, I do take issue with that because the original Enterprise, when it's shot with its shields down, it does do a lot of damage, and you get the whole thing with Scotty bringing his nephew up all bloodied. And,
yeah.
So actually, I do think... Yeah, there's a combat. There's two things that happens here. One is the fact they shoot through the shields and damage it, so they end up with a saucer sep. Then the engineering section blows up and knocks the saucer into the orbit of Viridian 3. Then the controls fail, so there's nothing that Deanna can do about it. So it's a combination of things that lead to the Enterprise getting destroyed. So I don't have a problem with that. But I do agree that they wanted to get rid of it in order to create something that looked better on a movie screen.
Yeah.
Because the Enterprise D does not look great in this, it has to be said, even with the extra detailing. It's the wrong proportions for a film. And that, you know... It is, because it was designed for a TV screen.
Yeah,
so.
But I like the D, and the E is beginning to look a bit spoonish.
We'll get on to the E later. Okay, we'll save ourselves for First Contact on that one.
Okay, well, I like the D, and I don't like that he gets blown up.
The whole reason for the holodeck nonsense on the ship, of course, was to start with something jolly before you got onto the slightly more depressing
stuff.
But
it's just bollocks.
Yeah. The Nexus is bad MacGuffin. I won't argue
terrible.
With that. That's definitely a point again.
And, you know, you called it the Hallmark Channel, Lee, but I think it's the first John Lewis ad.
It's just scary, that stuff. There's only one episode where Geordi's visor... Well, it's not even his visor. He's brainwashed by the Romulans using the connections to the visor. So it's not a reoccurring trope. This is literally only the first time something vaguely similar has happened. I do love the fact that he keeps calling Sauron Sauron, which brings a whole... Lord of the Rings flavour to it. But yes, okay, that unsurprisingly, a vote against. Shall we do my other compatriot from Space.Jury and find out what Mr. Andy Palastides makes of this one?
Hello, guys. Some real quick under-the-wire feedback for Generations. I'll try my very best to be brief. Firstly, I think the Enterprise B and Captain Harriman do get a bum rap. It is in no way their fault that some brass up the line decided today would be a good day to launch the Enterprise before the stuff is on board. And, you know, pack it full of journalists and everything like this. I mean, knowing a little bit about this sort of thing from the work I do with Lockheed and so forth, yeah, that's just completely unheard of. You would never launch a ship and expect it to be ready. You know, it would be trials and stuff like that as well. And why on earth is... In the solar system, the Enterprise the only ship available? I mean, it what, went out past Pluto? I mean, that's fuck all. And you know, a warp speed? I mean, that's a couple of minutes at most. Are you telling me there was nothing in space dock which could have gotten there like that? Ah, it's just stupidness. So yes, I do feel somewhat sorry for Captain Howerman. I know you're not a fan of the books, Anne-Marie, but he does get a better showing in those. And anyone who's interested, I highly recommend the Lost Era books, which is about... a lot of those are about the Enterprise B. Anyway, the original cast are completely superfluous and useless. There is zero reason for Kirk or any of them to be in this film. It adds nothing. It takes away from how good the ending of Star Trek VI was. It's just... Whatever. I don't know why they, halfway through the film, suddenly decide to swap to the Deep Space Nine uniforms. Oh, I mean, I do know they were originally going to have some new uniforms, but somewhere along the line they decided not to go with those. But then I don't know why they went with the Deep Space Nine ones and just didn't stick with the next-gen ones. The next-gen ones seemed perfectly serviceable to me. So yeah, that's just silly. It was nice seeing the bridge of the Enterprise, just a little bit more populated, more of a sense of, you know, stuff being done rather than it just being Picard's living room and everyone's just crashing out on his sofa. I think that's just about all my gripes. No, wait, two more. The big one is, how on earth does a bird of prey take down the flagship of the Federation, a galaxy-class starship? I mean, it makes no sense at all. Zero. No sense. It just shouldn't be possible. It's just stupid. Stupid! I mean how many times throughout all of Next Generation, when they engaged in some sort of combat with an enemy, you know, that can get through their shield, be it the Borg, be it the Ferengi, be it, you know, anything you want, anytime anything looks like it's getting through the shields, what is the first thing out of Worf's mouth every single time? We're rotating the shield frequencies, Captain. I mean, this is grade school stuff. I mean, I just... And on top of that, even if a bird of prey is able to fire through the shields and inflict, you know, some damage sort of thing, again, galaxy-class starship, we have established throughout most of the Next Generation, it is pretty much the single most powerful starship in the Federation fleet up until the Sovereign-class Enterprise-E. Yes, the Defiant is a, quote, tough little ship, end quote, but this is a galaxy-class starship. I mean, you know, Alpha Strike, that motherfucker, that thing should have been slag. There was just no excuse for that. The sheer incompetence of William T. Riker. I mean, this is the reason Riker never gets a command. It's shit like this. I mean, the guy is incompetent. Picard goes away for 5 minutes and Riker just goes to shit. He's got no idea whatsoever what he's doing. And it's unforgivable. It is completely unforgivable. Also, the Enterprise being destroyed over a no-name planet, you know, we never get a sense of stakes, and that's something that really annoys me. I mean, this was the Enterprise that we'd all, you know, well, I won't say growing up with, but we'd been with for the last 7-8 years, and it's just okay. If you're going to block the Enterprise, it should be in her heroic last stand. It should be doing something meaningful, saving some no-name planet with a population we never see or have any investment or any stakes in. It's just a waste. It's an excuse to just do a special effect. And the other thing which somewhat annoys me is Picard in the Nexus. I mean, the Nexus as it stands annoys me, but you can go anywhere, anytime, any place in all this. Okay, why don't we go back to the to 10 forward just after we met Tolian Soran and, I don't know, arrest him there and then. It, you know, there's plenty of evidence on the Amagosus Observatory that he's up to this sort of shit, so I don't know. Also, the whole, I mean, again, Kirk shouldn't be in this film at all, but did one of the producers hear that Kirk should die on a bridge and misread that as Kirk should die on a bridge, not the bridge? I still, to this day, don't quite understand who thought that was a good idea. Yeah, I mean, I'd like to say it's a noble failure. I mean, it's certainly not the worst Star Trek film. It's not even the worst Next Generation Star Trek film. But that's damning praise at best. So, yes, for what it's worth, Generations, it's... there are elements, you know, effects. Stellar cartography looks cool. Oh, fuck, I didn't even get onto Data and his sodding emotion shit. Oh, the less said about... I mean, you can see why when it came to First Contact, they tried to just pretend that never happened. So, yes, Generations, for what it's worth. Your mileage may vary, but fundamentally, it's a bit pants. Farewell, Enterprise-D. We hardly knew you. You certainly deserved a better ending than that. And, yes, I don't care what you say. A 5-ounce bird cannot carry a 1-pound coconut. Anyway, I will speak to you later, folks. Ta-ta!
Bye!
Bye!
Not even the worst Next Generation film is true enough.
No, it's true. I'm not going to argue with that.
Yeah. The Nexus is indeed wank. Yeah.
And the whole film is pants. Riker is incompetent.
He's regularly incompetent. So that's in keeping. Fair enough. That's in keeping with the series.
But I'd forgotten that about the Borg. Worf should be going rotate
the shield for. Yeah. I can't disagree with that.
But that continues. Worf is incompetent. Think of First Contact.
Yeah, no, they should be rotating the shield frequency. As soon as the first shots went through their shields like butter.
They should rotate exactly the frequencies. Right.
They shouldn't have got any other shots off after that. No argument from me. That's fair enough, yeah. Yes, the uniforms, very silly and annoying.
Yes.
Kirk is, I think, okay in this. I can live with Kirk, but obviously I...
But he doesn't belong there anyway.
Well, he does kind of.
No.
Oh, anyway. And yes, you're right, it's the top brass's fault that the beer's been sent out in unready condition. So yes.
Yeah, it's not Harriman's fault, it isn't Tuesday.
Cool.
So, one for me.
Yeah, we're even pegging now, and I have a feeling you might be shooting ahead soon. So, thank you, Andy. Next off, we hear from Fatbone Smith.
What's happened?
Robert and Rene there. Burned to death in a fire.
Do you smell something burning?
Too soon, Jim. Too soon. Generations was my second Star Trek cinema experience. I was 10 years old, and I have two particular memories of seeing it in the cinema. The first one is that when Data doesn't like the drink and he asks for more, that got a very big laugh from the crowd. And the second is that this is the first time I think I have a conscious memory of there being either a cello or a double bass in the music for a film. Now, a couple of occasions when this is a very low string note, and for whatever reason that stuck with me. The score in this is actually very good, with one exception.
Life forms.
That's enough of that. It's nice to be able to talk about Next Generation having good music for a change. And I think actually, if you had to task me with picking a piece of music that would be a sort of a piece of music that would represent all of Star Trek, I would probably pick the Overture from Generations. It's got the right sense of bold adventure to it. Other things about Generations that I thought worked very well were it looks great. It's a really wonderfully shot film. Really cinematic. A lot of people complain that the interior of the Enterprise looks too dark, and it does look dark, but it looks good dark. And I like the sunlight coming through the windows. Just this fantastically elegant, simple touch. They're in orbit of a star, so you get sunlight coming through the windows, and that gives you these great contrasty shots of light and dark and people moving between light and dark. And there's some very good acting in this as well, particularly from Patrick Stewart. That's almost redundant to say there's good acting from Patrick Stewart, but he does grief very, very well, the different sort of shades of it. Those are the good things about Generations. But as for the story and everything that happens in it, I have problems. I have difficulties with it. The first one I would say is when Picard's in the Nexus, Guinan says to her, if you were to leave the Nexus, you could go anywhere, anytime. You could go anywhere, anytime. So where does Picard decide to go when he does leave? He decides to go back to, you know, basically the point at which he entered the Nexus. He doesn't go, I know, I'll go back in time a week to the Enterprise, and I will tell my past self. And, you know, 6 or 7 months ago, I had a kind of time travel thing, so I'll believe myself when I tell myself this. I'll say, if you go to the Amagosa Observatory, there's a guy there called Soren. He's working with the Klingons. He's going to blow up some stars. It's going to kill a lot of people. Find him, arrest him, stick him in the brig for a week until the Nexus has gone by. And then in 39 years, it'll be someone else's problem. Oh, and give your brother a call. Tell him to make sure the smoke alarm's got a fresh battery in it. But he doesn't do that. And it's not like he doesn't have time to think about it. He's in the Nexus. He can take as long as he wants to come up with a plan. A lot of people complained about the death of Kirk in this. I wasn't too fussed by it. I think it's probably about as good a death for Kirk as Kirk was likely to get, if Kirk had to die at all. And I think actually Kirk is actually written quite well in that his sort of story harks back to the early TOS movies where he's become an admiral and he's not satisfied not being in the captain's chair anymore. But the death that really bothers me about Generations is the death of the Enterprise. Because it's just stupid. That ship, everything that ship has done, that ship deserved a hero's death. A meaningful, impactful, noble death. And it doesn't get one. It gets... You know, you hear about sometimes in the news, someone is in a fight and they get punched in the head and they fall down and they hit the head on the ground and they die. That's basically what happens to the Enterprise. It's a senseless, meaningless, wasteful death. And you know, it makes the people on the Enterprise look like idiots. You know, if you compare what Riker does in this to what Captain Keogh does in, what is it, the Jem'Hadar. Keogh realizes the Jem'Hadar can shoot through their shields, so he turns the shields off, uses the shield power to augment the phasers. Brilliant idea. What does Riker do? Keeps the shields up, and very slowly turns the ship away. What are you doing? They fire one phaser shot at the bird of prey, and when that doesn't work, oh, well, I'm out of ideas. What do we do? Something about an ionic pulse? We've seen the Enterprise open up with all its weapons, phasers, and photon torpedoes firing. We've seen it do it. Do that. Press the fire button until that bird of prey is gone. Your weapons are better than theirs. Their torpedoes are putting tiny little holes in the Enterprise. The Enterprise fires one torpedo, even though Riker tells Worf to fire a spread of torpedoes, which just means that Worf is a moron as well. One torpedo blows an unshielded bird of prey to bits. You have better weapons than they have. Use them. Destroy that thing. Or are you telling me that the only thing that makes the Federation flagship superior to the Klingon bird of prey, the fact that the Federation flagship has shields, it can't actually win weapons-wise? It's just ridiculous. And the galling thing about it, the really galling thing is, the Enterprise crash is really, really well done. It's spectacular. It's the model work is great, the stunts, there's people flying over the bridge, and edited really well, the music's really good, lots of energy and excitement. But the sequence, it comes as a result of everyone holding the idiot ball. Imagine what that sequence would have been if the Enterprise had died in a meaningful way, in an impactful way to the story. Because it doesn't impact the story at all. We as viewers, I guess, can sort of sit back and think, okay, well now Picard has to save all the people on the planet, and now he also has to save the crashed Enterprise crew who can't get away. Okay, fine. But Picard doesn't know that. He doesn't know the Enterprise has crashed, because he, like a fool, trusts that Riker isn't going to crash his ship, isn't going to get his ship shot out of the sky. No wonder Riker doesn't get another command until Nemesis. Shall we make Riker a captain? What, Riker? Are you fucking kidding? I mean, you know, you can find the crash video on YouTube, and in a rare instance of an insightful, interesting comment on YouTube, someone's written underneath it something like, light casualties, even at the end, the Enterprise looked after her crew. And it's true. It's absolutely true. Even half blown up and out of control, the Enterprise kept her crew safe. She looked after her crew far better than they looked after her. And she deserved better than them, and she deserved better from the writers. I think that's about all I have to say about Generations. Is there anything else? No, there isn't. So that's Generations. Two captains, one destiny, no refunds. Thanks for listening.
I think that was a vote against.
Yes, two captains, one destiny, no refunds.
5-4 it is, then.
And as also another comment on the destruction of the Enterprise should just fire at the bird of prey is a bloody good point.
Yes, if it opened up, they're not cloaked at this point, are they?
No.
The bird of prey, so just fire everything at it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it is an unjust destruction of the Enterprise. You lose that argument.
It's interesting because it also makes my point as well that actually the destruction is so well done.
Yeah, that's not the point.
I like the whole, you know, they find out that, yes, they should have rotated the shield frequencies.
Yeah.
But I do like the whole thing about them finding, using Geordi's visor to find out the shield frequency to open fire initially. It could have been better done, definitely. But ultimately, I do like the workaround. That's quite clever.
No, I like that initially. It should have happened and done one hit. And then A, rotate shield frequencies.
Yeah.
Already done it for the Borg, not a new thing. And B, fire Oka Bluey.
Also, somebody who liked the music, which is, I think, is a fair comment. And sometimes the darker lighting looks good.
Mostly
the bridge,
it
the bridge
like
does.
This.
Mostly it doesn't look good. No, both the Ready Room and 10 Forward look bad. In
yeah.
This.
Also, when you were talking about anywhere, anytime. Literally, I was writing, why not save Robert and Renee while you were saying, ring your brother up and get him to check the smoke alarm.
Thorbit,
because if
Nexus.
He can go to anywhere in the Nexus, then he can save his family and not have to have the fucking Christmas cheese of wank.
The Christmas cheese of wank, yes. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Let's find out what Ol made of this one.
Hello again, Orgs. It's Ol here, Ravine from the forums and various other places on the internet. I thought I'd feed back to you again. I was finding myself at a loose end the other day, and I thought, well, I could watch Star Trek V, which, as we all know, is one of the better Star Trek movies. But you know what? The Orgs are about to cover Star Trek Generations, so maybe I should give it another go, see what it's like. Well, shall we say, I was not impressed. Whilst the main plot is all right, I mean, I actually quite like the Kirk stuff, although when you think that it was written for Kirk, Spock and McCoy and they ended up with Kirk, Scotty and Chekhov, some of the lines in that don't make any sense with the characters they've got, like Chekhov suddenly declaring people to be nurses for no adequately explored reason. I like John Harriman. I think he's a really well-realised character in, you know, the few minutes we get to know him. It's just a sketch of a character, but it works really well. And that whole thing with Kirk, you know, finally heroically sacrificing himself one more time, it's so in character and works so well that you can't argue against it at all. Then we cut to the 100 years later or 80 years later or whenever it bloody is. Well, here's the thing. The story that happens with the Next Generation crew is basically fine. But there's a subplot. The festering turd in this film of a subplot is Data deciding to install the emotions chip and have emotions and experience emotions. Wow. So not only are we expected to believe that Geordi and Data can perform essentially brain surgery on each other without notifying anyone. You know, this is the second in command of the ship. Well, third in command of the ship, second officer. And the engineer is just going to radically alter his brain as a science experiment without telling anyone what's happened or putting into place any sort of possible way of sorting him out if it goes wrong. Really? You wouldn't ask the captain for some form of permission for, you know, changing the personality of the second ship, second officer. No? Okay, fine. Then we get some, I will call it comedy for lack of another word, but I tend to think of comedy as something that makes me laugh, and what Data was doing in this absolutely was not funny. So yes, then there was that, and then he basically acts like a complete tool in every scene he's in from now till the end of the film, when he swears in order to avoid getting a U rating in the cinema. Now, having got that off my chest, I'd like to talk about Dr. Sorin and his plan. Whilst Dr. Sorin is well realised, his plan is, well, physics doesn't work like that. You see, they talk about trilithium as being a fusion inhibitor. That means that you fire it into a star and the star switches off and stops being a star. It doesn't stop being there, though, does it? All the stuff that is in the star is going to stay where it is. It's just going to collapse down. It's probably still quite hot. It'd probably be a white dwarf, just a very hot lump of stuff sat in space with planets orbiting around it in exactly the same way they were before, just getting a lot colder. And gravitation around the area not changing a slightest bit. So it's sci-fi. I'm willing to buy a certain amount of nonsense in my science. However, A, that doesn't work, and B, Star Trek is a show that people keep trying to persuade me has good science in it, when clearly sometimes it really doesn't. It really gets up my bloody nose. Anyway, apart from that, I quite like bits of it. I mean, obviously the Patrick Stewart stuff is good, and it's always a good call to put Patrick Stewart at the centre of any plot you happen to have going. And he's good in this, you know. I think killing his family off screen was a bit unfair, a bit harsh. Seems a bit of a cheat to give him an emotional in, but fair enough. Okay, well, he ends up in the Nexus when talking to Kirk, and I'll just skimble over that because it's garbage. But you know, it makes sense in the end that he persuades Kirk to leave. And that's fine. I would say that the Nexus is set up as something that's so wonderful that you couldn't possibly want to leave, and Picard is out of there within about 5 minutes of getting there. But anyway, it works. You know, that's all fine. And he blows up the missile at the end, and hooray, it's all good. And we get rid of the Enterprise D, and thank goodness for that, because that's an awful, ugly ship. I hate it. Big, wide saucer and lumpy, long neck. Ugh. Horrible thing. So yes, glad to be rid of that. Well done for crashing it. There's good and bad, but I can't help but feeling that the flaws far outweigh the good stuff in this one. Sorry it's been a bit negative, chaps. I have no idea whether you liked it more than I did, but I kind of hope you did for your own sake. Anyway, it's thank you for your podcast. It's a really good show. And I will try and feed back to you next time you're covering one of the movies, because that's probably my limit. I shall speak to you next time, and I'll just play out with my normal theme tune, as I seem to have one now. Bye-bye!
Nice. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Although I'm not so sure about the Enterprise D hate. All
no.
Them fighting words around here.
Ooh, no. I didn't know that about a fusion inhibitor, but if it doesn't affect gravity, then it doesn't
Ouch.
Make any sense at
He's
all.
He's hitting us with science now. We're in trouble.
No. And yeah, why does the chief engineer radically alter the second officer's brain without asking? And it doesn't make any fucking sense that Soren is so desperate to get back to the Nexus that he'll destroy entire solar systems if it's something Picard just leaves in 5 minutes.
Just a little glance at a bauble and he's out. Mind you, considering the world that it created for him to live in, no wonder he wanted to get out of there quick. I mean, it's oh my God, it's a place of chintz.
So what's
that's suddenly we discovered why it's so bad. That's why Picard wants to leave. It makes sense. That the Nexus completely got it wrong when it came to Picard. Ah, you see that there is.
But that implies
logic.
That the Nexus isn't intelligence.
Well, it clearly is, and it's clearly got it horribly wrong.
So what's in Soren's that he's so desperate to get back to?
That's all the hookers, isn't it? The beer and the hookers, clearly.
Now what's in Guinan's then? She
candles, presumably.
Okay.
Thank you for that, sir.
Thank you. I am.
Oh, and yes, I completely agree. The data stuff is not great. Yes, you are winning 6-4. I bake it at the moment, and I'm sure. Well, let's find out what Drew and Tracy made. You never know. Might get a split vote at best on this one. We shall see.
There's two of them.
Yep.
If they disagree, we split that vote.
Yep.
Hello. This is our feedback for Star Trek film. Generations.
Right, the first thing I'm going to say is, like always in every film or in some of the episodes, they're the Enterprise B is the only ship in range.
Yeah, why was that?
Because
it's the only ship in range of Earth.
Yes, there should be like loads of ships.
Well, exactly, yeah. And also, it kind of, the captain... Did he not look like he was going to have a shit on his seat when he was like realised he had to go in there and actually do some work and go and do the rescuing?
He's a very unprepared captain,
yes,
isn't
exactly.
he? Is he John Harrison, I think he was called?
I can't remember.
He's very unprepared. I mean, are they really giving like a big old ship like the Enterprise B to
someone
who's
such a
like...
novice?
Exactly.
This is the Enterprise.
Although saying that, why launch it and it's not got torpedoes?
Well, exactly.
It's not got any medical staff. They did say, oh, we haven't tested the warp drives, but then as soon as it happens, they're like, oh, warp, go to warp speed. Yeah. So that's a bit of an error there. Oh, it's just a complete hash up.
Yeah.
Completely, isn't
but
it?
This is a film.
It is a film.
Take a step back.
Okay.
So noticeable absence of like key players like Spock and McCoy in this, and I just think if you're going to have some kind of old
dignity.
New world, then yeah, you need to have a bit of, you know, the key characters.
Well, Kirk's key enough.
Well, yeah, but Kirk is like the dude, isn't he? But Scotty was just a bit boring, and Chekhov was just like, sort out your Gary Glitter wig going on there, and just like, you're shit, what's going on? No, it was just bad. So Picard's face when he gets the news, and you don't know what it is at the time.
No.
But he gets the news, and he, oh my goodness, he just looks so sorrowful.
I know.
I just, you want to give him a cuddle, and I'd say to Troy, give him a cuddle.
Because on a rewatch, we know
we
what
know
it's about.
Why.
You know, at the first time, you don't know.
But oh my goodness.
He's a completely incredible actor,
Patrick
Stewart.
The scene where he actually tells Troy what's happened, oh my goodness, the emotion he conveys is just brilliant.
Cannot fault him at all.
Oh, love it. Very good. So why did Data's accent change when he got his
emotion chip?
Yeah, he almost seemed to become New Yorkie all of a sudden, didn't he?
When he's doing all the jokes.
Yeah.
He was like a New York comedian.
He was just...
I don't know.
Didn't quite buy it. We knew, obviously, because we've seen this film before, we knew that he wasn't supposed to have emotion and that it would get turned off. But it also kind of pointed me to the fact that this is the reason that androids aren't supposed to have emotions, because
they'd be turning to terrible New York comedians.
Yeah, they just tell shit jokes.
We was looking at the uniforms, weren't we? Why is the Forge's arms really long? They go on beyond these hands, and
Riker's were too short.
Too short,
but that's because you said that he was wearing.
I know that, obviously. Yeah, they're borrowing all the Deep Space
Nine. Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
I really don't like the look of the Next Generation uniform with the Voyager Deep Space
Nine
badges.
You really had an issue with the badges,
oh,
didn't you?
Terrible.
Yeah, you didn't like that at all.
The new style uniforms with the new badge is good, but the old ones. Without the oval, you
no, you didn't
to
like it at all. You did, yeah, you didn't like it at all. So for me, this was a really slow-paced film.
It is slow-paced, definitely.
Now, I kind of got bored halfway through. I've seen this before.
Seen it,
you know?
Most.
Yeah, exactly.
Saw it probably about 8 weeks ago at Christmas.
Yeah,
or
not that long
it.
Ago, and I don't know. It couldn't hold my attention tonight. Even George was snoring, you know, and I wanted to keep going off and doing stuff, and it just didn't have that kind
of. It's a different kind of beast, isn't it? It's different. It's very different. It's a feature film for the movies, so it's got appeal to the whole to people who are not into Star Trek. It's very difficult for me to judge this compared to like the episodes. It's just it's a different thing. I like this,
it's
you know.
It's hard for you to be objective because you are such a Trekkie.
I like this because if it's on at Christmas or it's on a bank holiday Monday, you'll watch it and you enjoy it.
Yeah.
But does it compare to episodes? Probably not. I don't know.
Episodes like what?
Well,
Next Generation?
Like Next Generation, yeah. I mean, obviously it's better than some of the rubbish.
Well,
ones.
Some of the rubbish we fucking Season watch 7. For Next Generation. But, yeah, sorry. It's bollocks, but...
I think it's good. It's a good film. We're going to leave it at that,
it's
I think.
Right.
Are you going with that?
It's all right, yeah. It's a good
Star Trek film.
I kind of wrote down, it wasn't the worst. It's definitely not the best film, but compared to something like Insurrection, I'll definitely watch Generations
well,
over Insurrection
till
again.
Let's wait we get to Insurrection, shall we?
Well, we might just pass over that one. The only thing I've got to say is when the girl lost her teddy, it was like, no!
Oh, yeah, when there was the talks of separation.
Like, yeah,
person
that's
the heartback,
just...
Yes.
That is just like, you know, tragedy.
Traumatic.
Yeah!
And we liked when Data found Spot, didn't we?
Oh,
so,
we did love that.
Yeah,
yeah. Loved that. But then we
tender
loved
moment.
Spot.
Anyway, let's end there.
Yeah. Enjoyed it.
I enjoy it a lot. It's a good feature film.
Yeah. And let's leave it there. And I have to say, I have newfound love for Kirk, William Shatner. You kept telling me to shush it when I kept saying that to you throughout the film, but I just think he's great. I'm a Shatner fan.
He is good, yeah, he is good.
I love him. Anyway, on to the next film. See you later, guys.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Yeah, not for the first time. You think they hate this, don't they? Oh, they absolutely... Hang on, they like this. So I think that's a vote for me. Mm. Bizarrely. Which makes it 5-6 to you.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah, I mean, they're right. It's better than most of season 7.
Yeah, well...
No, but then that is damning with faint praise.
Yeah, I mean... It's better than some episodes of season 7, but taken as a whole, season 7 makes me less cross.
No, the season 7 makes me more cross. But anyway...
It's definitely better than Insurrection. No arguments there.
Yes, I think anybody could possibly argue with that. But anyway, Harriman is not unprepared. The bloody ship is unprepared that he's given the command of. That is not his fault.
No.
He's not the one who orders in the parts for it. Whichever fecking admiral is responsible for sending that ship out too soon, they should be bloody shot.
Yes. But I like that androids can't cope with emotions. They become bad New York comedians.
Yes. Or Brent Spiner. Anyway.
Yeah, same thing.
Yeah. I think he's from the South, actually, rather than New York. But anyway.
Fair enough. I wouldn't know. But yeah, just no.
Just no.
Just no. And every time anybody says they are a Shat fan, I'm afraid I go to a Royal and Rat place.
Shat fan.
No, it's going to go, yee, Shat fans.
Okay, let's find out what the Pie Man made of this one. It'll either end in a draw if he likes it, or this will be your winning vote. The tension! The tension!
Well, no, at the moment I'm winning.
At the moment, yes, but this could result in a draw, which is better than I could have possibly hoped for.
Oh, in which case I'm going to Twitter.
Hello, orcs. Parry here to talk about Star Trek Generations. Now, it's interesting. I was never that keen on this film, and indeed my opinion hasn't really changed in this rewatch. However, it was interesting to find out that there are some people who really like this, and in fact consider it one of the best of the next-gen films. I think the argument is that it's the most next-gen of the next-gen films, i.e. the ensemble cast get more to do. So Riker gets a bit, Troy gets a wee bit, Data, Geordi, even Crusher, they all get something to do, and it's a bit more ensemble, whereas obviously the later films became the Picard and Data show, and I do see that. That said, I'm just not that keen on this, and I think part of the problem is it was built on basically a premise. You know, it wasn't someone had a good story to tell. Someone wanted Kirk and Picard to meet to have a handing over of the torch, and I'm not entirely sure that works really well, or indeed was entirely necessary. We'd had that scene in Encounter at Farpoint with McCoy, and I mean, apparently the original sort of drafts had Kirk and co. on the Enterprise A fighting Picard and the Enterprise D until they realised that there is no way you can make that fight happen, which doesn't make Picard look like a complete spanner, because, let's face it, his ship, if nothing else, has got, you know, a good 70 years development compared to the Enterprise A, so no matter how good Kirk is, Picard would literally have to be having trouble finding his own shoes to lose that fight. So then they came up with the idea that they team up to face a common foe. And again, I think, and I've not actually reread it, I didn't mean to before this, there was a book called Federation which came up with a similar idea, but had the idea of a kind of crisis that started in Kirk's time and then through a black hole basically the ships pass each other, but they're both sort of working towards the same event, just happening in kind of a timey-wimey zone. And I quite like the idea of if you'd actually taken out the Kirk-Picard meeting in this, then it could have been a not bad film. But, you know, obviously the point is that they were always working around this idea of Kirk and Picard meeting. Because I don't actually mind Kirk's death. I know a lot of people wanted Kirk to be on the bridge of a starship, you know, fighting till the last, and, you know, him and his ship would basically go down together. And I actually don't mind him getting sort of basically sucked into the next or killed on the Enterprise B, saving the ship and people. That said, a lot of people on that opening scene, and I actually was quite with it on the opening scene, I quite enjoy that opening sequence with Kirk and the two crew members who can put their love of conservatories over their hatred of Shatner with the launch of the Enterprise B. I'm not as keen on the Enterprise B. I've mellowed to it over the years. The thing is, I like the Excelsior class design as it is, and putting basically love handles on it is, it was just to try and make it look a bit more Enterprise D-ish, and we kind of had the Enterprise C for that. Again, this is almost a yes, yes, but movie watchers might not be TV watchers, but come on, this is Star Trek, really. So you have,
you know, you have those scenes, and there's been people who got at Harriman saying Harriman was useless, and again, it's one that I think over analysis, you actually go, no, actually, I'm with Harriman. Harriman knew the state of his ship. He knew he had a skeleton crew, half his kit wasn't sold. This was a publicity junket. They weren't even meant to be going to warp. They were meant to just be flying out to Pluto and back to get the press on, Kirk on the bridge, etc., etc. The fact that they then pulled on to rescue, he's trying to be careful. He's making sure, at the beginning, when he's not wanting to go and he's trying to find ways not to approach too closely, he's trying to make sure that instead of two ships getting blown up there, it's three, which Kirk very nearly puts them into, when you think of it that way. Now, Kirk dying, I do actually love that scene. Scotty and Chekhov standing there with the who was in there. Oh, someone was in there. But then, of course, we pan up to the next gen. And again, I quite like the scene on the boat. For all that, I don't like the killing off of Picard's family just to really make him sad. I wasn't happy with that. I thought, considering we only met these characters like once, I thought we were more attached to them to have them bumped off screen just to make a plot point. That kind of annoyed me a little. Data pushing Crusher into the water is funny. I don't care what the crew say. But I think this is where the film loses me. I think the film loses me with Data's emotion chip. And that said, well, I've got downsides of seeing the TNG sets on a big screen, mainly that they'd obviously dimmed the lights so that the sets could work on a kind of movie-style resolution, or your pin-sharp crikey vision. I don't know how the sets look in the Blu-rays, but I think that was possibly why they suddenly muted all the lighting and that sort of thing. But that said, we do have the upshot that we get to see the Enterprise looking quite crowded. You know, they could really flesh out the episodes. For once, 10 Forward looks busy. Not just like a few people milling about, it's actually quite crammed, and I really like things like that. Indeed, the little tweaks to the Enterprise bridge make it look better, so it's rather a shame that they smashed the lot up. I know a lot of people weren't happy that the Enterprise D didn't survive, but I can sort of see the idea that they needed to build whole new sets and models to work on a movie, and they might as well give her a good send-off. I actually quite like the way that no Enterprise ever survives. You know, there's always something that takes the ship out, it's just something to do with the name. And I think this is where kind of the film loses me. In the next gen time, you've got Picard being made sad just to give him plot points, and you've got Data kind of just being annoying. I like Roy Riker. If you actually look at me, he's got a fuck-off look whenever he sees Data doing his sort of emotion thing. And I think the forced comedy just doesn't really work with that. There's also quite a lot of scenes cut. There's a scene with Geordi getting a kind of heart implant that tortures him, which they mention later, but don't do anything with. The fight scene's quite good between the Enterprise and the Bird of Prey, but then Picard goes to the Nexus, and you lose so much respect from him, and you realise his ultimate fantasy is a twee Christmas with, "Hello, Papa. Is it going to be Christmas? Shall you come and have a dinner? It's all ready and the goose looks lovely." Oh, God, get rid of them. And again, a lot of it just seems to be plot devices. Malcolm McDowell's pretty much there as the baddie. I think they tried to make him a bit complex, but he is just hamming it up in his usual hamming up baddie way. So I think that's a bit of a shame. I think really they could have done something better with this. Even with the Nexus idea, they could have maybe done something better, but as a result, it just all seems a bit lackluster. The Next Generation bits in particular really just meander through, and I think it's nice to see the Next Generation brought to big screen in arguably its only truest form, but it doesn't make up for the fact that this is a fairly dull movie. Has a lovely soundtrack, though. I really do like, considering it is all the TV people here, I think the later ones, they started getting more movie people involved, and considering this is basically the TV people playing in the big leaves, I think they've got Dennis McCarthy to do the soundtrack, and I actually really like it. So there is a lot to like, and I'm glad all these people got the shot at doing big TV things, but I'm equally glad that they got a movie person to come in. So with that, I shall leave my extra long feature length feedback, just to say do keep up the good work. I'm enjoying the podcast, and I'll hopefully continue feeding back throughout all of Deep Space Nine. So until then, bye for now.
Bye, sir. Bye. Thank you for that. I think that makes it then 7-5 in your favour, which I think is fair. I think most people are again this film, but interestingly, it's closer than I thought it might be. So it's fascinating. So there we go. It certainly has its flaws.
See, I think you counted wrong because Drew and Tracy liked it, so I think I win 7-6, don't I?
Not sure. I maybe lost count at some point because I've had a few beers.
Yeah, so have I. But, yeah, killing Picard's family just to make him sad.
Ah, it's cheap, isn't it? Particularly, and then not even using the same actor's faces just really undermines it all badly. It does. Badly.
Yeah. And, yeah, handing on the torch is just not necessary. And Crusher in the Water is funny. You and I agree on that.
Yes, we do. That is funny.
Yes.
there we go. So that's our Generations coverage. Wow, that was fairly epic, wasn't it?
Got that out of the way. Hooray. Yeah.
And thank you to everybody who's fed back.
Thank you.
Shared the pain, shared the joy, whatever. Next time for bOrgCast 8.2, back to Deep Space Nine.
Yay.
And we'll be on Deep Space Nine for a while now. Recording on Thursday the 17th of March, we shall be covering The House of Quark.
Don't know that one.
Quark gets himself a girlfriend.
Still don't know that one.
A Klingon girlfriend.
Still don't know that
one. Oh, really? Because it's fantastic. I seem to remember Garon's in it as well.
Oh, that sounds awesome. Yes.
And I shall be covering Equilibrium, which is looking into the murky past of one of Dax's hosts.
Oh yes.
So I think two good episodes there.
Yeah, well, I wouldn't know about House of Quark because I don't know what that one is. I mean, it might be one of those ones with 5 minutes in, I go, oh, it's that one. But from your description, I have no idea.
Splendid stuff. If you'd like to feedback, then all the various ways of doing so are listed at the end of this podcast. So we shall catch you next time. Cheery bye.
Bye.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's truly a real honorable experience to be here this evening. A very wonderful and warm and emotional moment for all of us. And I'd like to sing a song for all of you. It's Christmas in heaven. All the children sing.
The bOrgCast is brought to you by the lovely people at geekplanetonline.com.
All music referenced is for illustrative purposes only, and no copyright infringement is intended.
To contact us, you can use the forums at geekplanetonline.com.
Visit our Tumblr site at bOrgCast.tumblr.com, where you'll find images accompanying the episodes discussed in this cast.
Send email messages or MP3s to bOrgCast@geekplanetonline.com.
Or you can contact us via Twitter on rev_org or bOrgCastAmmo. Hashtag bOrgCast.
The sound of music twice an hour and Jaws 1, 2 and 3.
There's gifts for all the family. There's toiletries and drains.
Yes, sir. And the latest video games.
It's Christmas in heaven. Hip, 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 hooray. Every single day is Christmas Day. It's Christmas in heaven.
Shut it down!